Συλληπρία στον όνο και εγίνη στον εφορών, τον εσκά της χρόνης φανέντα, αρετή εις φιλών μισιών, νεκτάριον τιμήσομεν πιστή, ως εν Θεόν θεράποντα Χριστού, αναβλύζει γαριάς εις παντόδα πας, εις ευλαβός κραυγάζουσι, δόξα το σε δόξα σαν τη Χριστό, δόξα το σε θαυμαστό σαν τη, δόξα το ενεργούν τη βία σου πασινιάματα. Spring of Silivria and the guardian of Aegina, the true friend of virtue who didst appear in the last years. O Nectarius, we faithful honor thee as a godly servant of Christ. For the poor is worth healings of every kind, for those who piously cry out, glory to Christ who hath glorified thee. Glory to him who hath made thee wondrous. Glory to him who worketh healings for all through thee.
Okay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, welcome everyone. It's very nice to see you here tonight. And we're here to do two things. Okay, so we're here to do two things. One is to see off our father, our higher deacon Luke, who is called within. He has a curious, who has a desire to live in a higher discipline at the monastery and attend to his spiritual life. And so he's going to leave us and spend hopefully the rest of his life with Metropolitan Demetrius and the other fathers whom he is no stranger to. And so it's our fond farewell for our father. But then also Father Panotti wanted to say a few words about the beginning of the parish, because Father Luke was just a young man, maybe 20 years old in the beginning of the parish. And so it's an occasion for us to remember those early days, and of course through the retelling of certain stories and certain reflections on those early days. So with those, with that introduction, I ask Father Panotti to begin his talk. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, blessed Master, Holy Fathers, I'm going through some physical problems, so my talk tonight might be a little bit disjointed. Just bear with me. Now that Father Luke is leaving us, it caused me to do some reflection, because Father Luke was one of the first people I met when I came to Toronto in 1966. He was about 20 years old, and we've been more or less together all these years. And Father Luke is one of the few remaining survivors of the founders of this parish. Seraphim Koutsianis is here, is one of them. Michael Maragoudas, who can't come tonight, is one of them. And I don't know if there's anyone else. Stavro Batskos was one of them. Kliathis Savas was one of them. And we all were, as you probably know, in the New Calendar Church. What I would like to do tonight is speak a few words in English and then repeat myself in Greek. Απόψε θα μιλήσω λίγο. Έκανα μερικές σκέψεις γύρω από το γεγονός που όταν ήρθα στο Τορόντο το 1966, από τους πρώτους χριστιανούς που γνώρισα εδώ στο Τορόντο ήταν ο πατέρας Λουκάς, που ήταν τότε 20χρονό παιδί. Και έκτοτε έχουμε ένα πνευματικό δεσμό που βαστάει μέχρι σήμερα, αδέλφια, με μεγάλη αγάπη. Και ο πατήρ Λουκάς είναι από τους ιδρυτάς της συνορίας μας. Δεν έχουμε μείνει πολύ, έχει μείνει ο Σεραφείμ, ο Κοτσιάνας είναι εδώ κάπου. Ο Μιχάλης, ο Μαραγκούλας, ο φαρμακοποιός έχει μείνει, ο Σταύρος, ο Μπάσκος ήταν μαζί μας στον Άι Δημήτρη, ο Κλεάνθης, ο Σάββας. Τώρα λέω για αυτούς που ήμασταν μαζί στον Άι Δημήτρη, διότι από εκεί ξεκινήσαμε. Οι περισσότεροι έχουν πάει στον προορισμό τους. I would like to start off tonight with an image. I hope most of you have seen it someplace. There is an icon. It is the icon of the ship, the church as a ship. And it shows our Lord at the rudder, steering the ship, the holy disciples and the apostles manning the sails and keeping the ship afloat, fighting the various difficulties that one can find in an ocean, and other enemies who are attacking the ship. And that ship is being guided to the harbor of the kingdom of heaven. And it is our Lord who guides it, assisted by the saints. And on that ship are the believers, us, the Christians. We're there. They are guiding us. They're taking us to our destination, which is the kingdom of heaven. And on this path to this destination, there will be many difficulties, but under the guidance of our Savior, and with the help of all the saints, we remain assured that we will reach our destination. I remember as a young student of theology, we had meetings with various different religious groups. And once we were at an Anglican seminary, and I spoke similar words about the church being the ship which Christ steers and the holy apostles work on. And one Anglican seminarian said to me, "Well, what about the rest of us that aren't on that ship?" And I said, "Well, I'd hate to be in a rowboat in a storm. So, but I know we're in a ship and you're on the rowboat. Good luck." That reminded me, it goes back a long time ago. Yeah, the ship is a lot better to be in, especially if it's guided by our Savior and worked by the holy saints, than a little rowboat. And this is a truth. This icons teach us, and this is a very important thing, because our Lord has us heading towards a certain destination, which is the kingdom of heaven. And if we leave that ship, if we abandon the boat, abandon the church, then we lose our chances of reaching the safe shore of the kingdom of heaven. Our Lord is taking us out of the place, leading us to the place, and we have this from the early scriptures. If the Hebrew people did not leave Egypt, where they were very, very comfortable, compared to the Sinai journey of 40 years, they would never have reached the promised land. And the same thing about us. If we had never left the heresy of ecumenism, we would never be able to get on the ship that hopefully, through the prayers of all the saints, under the guidance of our Savior, we may reach the shore of the promised land. Αγαπητοί χριστιανοί, απόψε ήθελα να σας φέρω μια ωραία εικόνα. Πιστεύω ότι οι περισσότεροι θα την έχετε δει. Είναι μια ωραία εικόνα που δείχνει ένα καράβι. Πίσω στο καράβι, στο πεδάλιο δηλαδή, είναι ο Χριστός μας και κατευθύνει, δίνει την κατεύθυνση του καραβιού. Στο καράβι απάνω, στις πάνες και σε άλλα μέρη, δουλεύουν οι Άγιοι Απόστολοι και όλοι οι Άγιοι για να μπορεί το καράβι να περάσει τις τρικυμίες που υπάρχουν σε μια θάλασσα. Γύρω από το καράβι υπάρχουν εχθροί, πειρατές, υπάρχει άνεμος, υπάρχουν κύματα, αλλά με τον Χριστό μας που μας κατευθύνει στο καράβι αυτό και με τους Αγίους που εργάζονται, εμείς που είμαστε επιβάτες στο καράβι αυτό, έχουμε μια ελπίδα ότι μία μέρα θα φτάσουμε στον προορισμό μας, ο οποίος προορισμός είναι η γη της επαγγελίας, η βασιλεία των ουρανών. Εκεί μας έχει προορίσει ο Κύριος να βρεθούμε όλοι. Και αν μείνουμε στο καράβι αυτό, έχουμε ελπίδες ότι μια μέρα θα φτάσουμε τον προορισμό μας. Και πραγματικά η Εκκλησία είναι το καράβι του Χριστού, όπου υπάρχει σωτηρία. Θυμάμαι τώρα που ετοίμαζα λίγα λόγια απόψε, όταν ήμουν φοιτητής, τακτικά είχαμε συναντήσεις με φοιτητάς θεολογίες από άλλα δόγματα. Και είχαμε πάει κάποτε σε μια ιερατική σχολή που ήταν Αγγλικανή. Και έλεγα τα ίδια που έλεγα απόψε, και εκεί πως η Ορθοδοξία είναι το καράβι αυτό που είναι ο Χριστός, οι Άγιοι Απόστολοι, και εμείς βρισκόμαστε στο καράβι αυτό και με την ελπίδα ότι θα φτάσουμε στην γη της Επαγγελίας. Και ένας Αγγλικανός λέει, και εμείς που δεν είμαστε στο καράβι, τι θα γίνει? Λέω, κοίτα, αν είμαστε σε μια θάλασσα και υπάρχει τρικυμία, πού θα είναι καλύτερα, να είσαι στο καράβι ή μέσα σε ένα μικρό βαποράκι? Και όλοι γελάσανε και καταλάβανε. Αλλά νομίζανε ότι ήμουν φανατικός. Δεν ήταν ωραία να μιλάω έτσι, να λέω ότι αυτοί θα πνιγούνε και εμείς θα σωθούμε. Αλλά εγώ έλεγα απλώς ότι εμείς έχουμε ελπίδες να φτάσουμε τον προορισμό μας. Δεν εννοεί ότι θα το φτάσουμε, γιατί μπορεί και πάνω στο καράβι που είμαστε να ζαλιστούμε, να πέσουμε και να φύγουμε, πέσουμε μέσα στην θάλασσα. Δεν εννοεί ότι επειδή βρισκόμαστε στο καράβι του Χριστού ότι θα φτάσουμε στον προορισμό μας. Πρέπει να μείνουμε εκεί και να μείνουμε πιστοί. Και αυτή είναι η εικόνα που μας δίνει ο Χριστός μας από την Παλαιά Διαθήκη. Σκεφτείτε καλά, οι Εβραίοι όταν φύγανε από την Αίγυπτο, όπου είχαν κάποια αναλόγως καλή ζωή, όταν φύγανε, τους κάλεσε ο Θεός να φύγουν από την Αίγυπτο, να πάνε πού? Στην έρημο της Σινάκ, όπου ταλαιπωρηθήκανε 40 χρόνια μέχρι να φτάσουν στην γη της Επαγγελίας. Αν δεν φεύγανε, δεν θα φτάνανε ποτέ. Έτσι κι εμείς, αγαπητοί μου χριστιανοί, εδώ και σχεδόν 60 χρόνια, φύγαμε από την Αίγυπτο, όπου υπήρχε μια, θα λέμε, άνετη ζωή, και διαλέξαμε να ακολουθήσουμε την κατεύθυνση του Χριστού μας και να φύγουμε μέσα στην έρημο της Σινά, με την ελπίδα ότι μια μέρα θα μας φέρει ο Χριστός μας στη γη της Επαγγελίας, όταν φύγαμε δηλαδή από το νέο ημερολόγιο. The worst part of the heresy of ecumenism, and the reason why we who were once members of the New Calendar Church, we left was because of ecumenism, which is a heresy. The worst part of the heresy of ecumenism is its attempt to secularize the church, to destroy the church. It's an attempt to destroy the ship of Christ, turn it from a ship into a rowboat. And as we said, we know rowboats don't have much success in a storm. The heresy of ecumenism taught us and teaches us and attempts to lead us to believe that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is not the only way that we can find God, that there are many, many other ways. And way back in the 60s, we saw the ecumenical movement adopt shaman practices, African witch doctors, Greek pagan gods, Hindus. I remember it was maybe 1960, 61, around there, where was a great meeting in India of the ecumenical movement. Archbishop Yakovos, who came back from that meeting and was one of the leaders of the ecumenical movement, told us, as I was a student at that time, and came to give a talk on that, on what happened in New Delhi. He told us he saw the grace of God shining in the face of the Hindus. They had openly come to believe that God could be found not only through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but through other means. In other words, they were advocating abandon the ship and get into the little rowboats. This latest attack of ecumenism on our church didn't start in 1960. I would say it maybe reached a culmination in the 60s. It had started for the Orthodox, it had started at least 200 years before. And in Russia, under the movement from Peter the Great and on, ending, culminating in the great Bolshevik Revolution, which saw so many millions of martyrs. And in Greece, starting at the time before the Greek Revolution and ending up with the change of the calendar in 24. It's amazing how historically we see the time frame that these things, these events happen at about the same time. And things looked very bad. In Russia, the Bolsheviks seemed to be so strong and completely destroying the church. And in Greece, the new calendarists, and in the Middle East, where the new calendarists were, again, destroying the church. And yet, our Lord and Savior, that we had said earlier from the icon, who was guiding the ship through the storm, guided the church through these horrible events to be able to come out today stronger than it had been at that time that when it was attacked. To chirotero meros tis eresios tu ecumenismu ine ο μοντερνισμός, η προσπάθεια δηλαδή να εγκοσμικευθεί την Εκκλησία, δηλαδή να γίνει η Εκκλησία απλώς ένα κοσμικό ίδρυμα, να γίνει η Εκκλησία μια, θα λέγαμε, μια κοινότητα κοινωνική, ένας σύλλογος όπου οι άνθρωποι πηγαίνουν περισσότερο για κοινωνικούς λόγους. Και ο οικονομισμός το έχει καταφέρει αυτό με πολλή δουλειά εδώ και εκατοντάδες χρόνια. Οι εκκλησίες να αλλάξουν και να χάσουν την πνευματική τους κατεύθυνση, την κατεύθυνση που οδηγεί στην Βασιλεία των Ουρανών, και να γίνουν κοσμικά ιδρύματα, κοσμικοί σύλλογοι. Πώς έχουμε ο σύλλογος του χωριού και η εκκλησία είναι σαν ένας σύλλογος. Εμείς όταν μεγαλώνουμε έτσι βλέπουμε την εκκλησία, ήταν το κοινωνικό κέντρο μας. Είχε κάτι πνευματικά αλλά λίγα πράγματα, ελάχιστα. Και αυτή είναι η προσπάθεια που έκανε, που φέρνει ο οικουμενισμός. Ο μεγαλύτερος κίνδυνος είναι η εκκλησία να γίνει κοσμικό ίδρυμα. Και αυτό έγινε με μεγάλος αγώνας. Γι' αυτό είδαμε ότι μέσα σε 200 χρόνια, γιατί ο αγώνας αυτός βάστηξε περίπου 200 χρόνια και παραπάνω, αλλά 200 χρόνια. Μέχρι το 1960 είδαμε η αλλαγή στο ότι αρχίζουν και αυτοί που λεγόταν σαν Ορθόδοξοι Χριστιανοί να πιστεύουν ότι δεν είναι μόνο ο Χριστός που μπορεί να μας σώσει, μπορεί ο Βούδας να μας σώσει, μπορεί ο Αλλάχ να μας σώσει, μπορεί και ο Δίας να μας σώσει, μπορούν και ακόμα οι μάγοι της Αφρικής να μας σώσουν. Και γι' αυτό αρχίζανε και κάνανε συμπροσευχή με μάγους από την Αφρική, με ειδωλολάτρες, με μουσουλμάνους, με Εβραίους, με Βουδιστάς. Και θυμάμαι το 1960 περίπου θα ήταν, δεν είμαι σίγουρος. Ήμουν ακόμα φοιτητής θεολογίας και ο αρχιεπίσκοπός μας, ο αρχιεπίσκοπος Ιάκωβος της Αμερικής, τότε έγινε μεγάλο συνέδριο του οικουμενισμού στις Ινδίες, Νέα Δελχή. Και ήρθε πίσω στην θεολογική σχολή να μας μιλήσει, να μας πει τι έγινε εκεί, διότι είμαστε μέλλοντες ιερείς και έπρεπε να φωτιστούμε για να μάθουμε περισσότερο για τον οικουμενισμό. Και μας έλεγε ότι όταν ήταν στη Νέα Δελχή στις Ινδίες, έβλεπε, λέει, ο αρχιεπίσκοπος, έβλεπε το φως του Αγίου Πνεύματος εις τα πρόσωπα των Ινδών. Σαν να μας έλεγε, τι καθώς είστε στο καράβι της Ορθοδοξίας, στο καράβι του Χριστού, πετακτείτε, φύγετε. Ότι όπως είπαμε, ότι μπορεί να είμαστε στο καράβι του Χριστού, αλλά υπάρχει ο κίνδυνος ότι θα φύγουμε από το καράβι και τότε θα πνιγούμε. Και αυτό ερχόταν από τον αρχιεπίσκοπο να μας διδάσκει τέτοια πράγματα. Και μαζί με τις δυσκολίες αυτές αρχίσανε να καταραίωνε ό,τι πνευματικό είχε η Ορθοδοξία και να το καταστρέφει. Είπαμε, το κίνημα αυτό είχε αρχίσει πριν από 200 χρόνια. Στην Ρωσία, με τον ερχομό του Τσάρου Πέτρου, μπήκε ο Ευρωπαϊσμός μέσα στη Ρωσία και κατέληξε με τους κομμουνιστάς, οι οποίοι σφάξανε εκατομμύρια χριστιανούς. Στην Ελλάδα μπήκε η διαφώτιση της Ευρώπης, στην Ελλάδα, λίγο πριν από την Επανάσταση και τελικά καταστρέψανε την Επανάσταση και γυρίσανε την Ελλάδα σε ένα ευρωπαϊκό γαλλικό κράτος με γερμανό μη ορθόδοξο βασιλέα και με εκκλησία η οποία ήταν αντίγραφο της γερμανικής προτεστάντικης εκκλησίας. Και τελικά φτάσανε εκεί που θέλανε το 24 να αλλάξουν και το ημερολόγιο για βήμα προς βήμα να καταστρέφουν το καράβι αυτό του Χριστού μας. Αλλά ο Θεός, όπως είπαμε, ο Χριστός μας ήταν ο καπετάνιος, διεύθυνε το καράβι. Οι Άγιοι δουλεύανε. Δεν μας άφησε να χαθούμε. Το καράβι δεν βούλιαξε. Και έδωσε ο Χριστός δύναμη και φώτιση σε χριστιανούς να αντιδράσουν σε αυτές τις προσπάθειες του οικουμενισμού. In 1964, the Pope of Rome met with the then Patriarch Athenagoras of Constantinople in Jerusalem and lifted the anathemas, in other words, joined the Roman Catholic Church with the Orthodox Church officially. And this was done with a great ceremony. Everybody was happy about it. And it was at that time there was confusion among the ordinary people because most people didn't really know what all this meant. In 1966, just 2 years after this, when I arrived in Toronto, I found that the churches, the New Calendar churches that practice ecumenism had shown that they were already badly influenced by modernism, which is, I said, is the most potent weapon of ecumenism, the changes. Everything had changed. The services were corrupted. The divine liturgy was cut down. Vespers, there was no such thing as Vespers in any church. The saints' feast days were not really celebrated. Wedding services, baptism services, at least sometimes 50%, sometimes 60% or more of the service was cut out, eliminated. The exorcisms at the beginning, they're all eliminated. Children were not being immersed in the baptismal font. And when I came to this, I saw this situation here in Toronto. I was a bit shocked because up until then, I had really not much experience of the world. I was just a student all my life. And Toronto was my first worldly experience. I was exposed to the world here in Toronto. And all this overwhelmed me. When I first was ordained, I wore my robes, I had a beard, and this shocked and scandalized the local bishop in Toronto and all the priests. They started a campaign, and I received a letter from New York, where the headquarters was, to immediately take off my robes, get rid of my prayer robe, and shave my beard by the 15th of August, which was my name day, or else I wouldn't be allowed to serve any longer. That would be my punishment. I was depressed. We had no family here, no one that really I knew of. A few people I had met, one of which was Father Luke. As I said, at 66 I met him, he was only 20 years old. A few people like Father Luke, his sister, his mother, his father, and the rest of the family. And I became close to them, but that was really not much help at that time for me. And I was extremely depressed, not knowing what to do, being away from my family, being in a strange country. Canada for an American is a strange country. And at that time, one of the people I had met, actually she was one of the church school teachers, Father Luke's sister Constantina was also a church school teacher. This girl was from Athens and had some contact with Mother Meletia, the abbess of the convent of St. Irene Christovolando that we were celebrating. And she corresponded with the abbess, and she wrote about the abbess that I was here, and you know that this and this was happening. And the abbess, Mother Meletia, who founded that convent, the great convent, which is today the pride and joy of the old calendarist, wrote a letter to me encouraging me and wishing that one day I would join the old calendar church, which up until then, I had no idea what the old calendar church was. Because I remember something about old calendarists when I was growing up. We were told, oh, they're all a bunch of crazy people, don't pay any attention to them. And we didn't, you know. When somebody said they're crazy, you just stay away from crazy people. Because there was an old calendar parish in Boston at the time I was growing up, but we just stayed away from them, they were crazy. So that letter, at that time, it was a bit of a consolation. I chose to shave, take off my robes, hide my prayer robe, so that I could stay serving until something could happen that could make, I don't know what I was waiting for to happen, but anyway. And things did happen. At that time in Toronto, as I said, modernism is the worst part of ecumenism. They had destroyed, if you can believe it, they had destroyed the Feast of Pascha. There was no Paschal service in any church in Toronto. By 1967, when I was at St. Demetrius, there were four new calendar churches in Toronto. Every Pascha, all four churches were forced by the bishop to close down. And we all had to go to Maple Leaf Gardens, back then the main hockey arena. And the price of the candles were jacked up 10 times. The bishop would come and the president of the community would come and give sermons on how they needed money. And when the trade goes around, they didn't want to hear the sound of coin. Unbelievable, huh? Remember that? Don't want to hear coin dropping, they said. Well, from the very beginning, I told Presidenta, you can't go to any of these services. I'll have to go. So I sent her to the Antiochian church, which she was familiar with, so that she could at least have some sort of a Pascha. And I would go by myself, and I'd come home so depressed and so dejected. But there was nothing I could do. In the meanwhile, God sent us St. Philaret, who at that time took a worldwide approach and published his famous encyclicals against ecumenism in such a way that it was so enlightening. We had never known of St. Philaret or of the Russian Synod abroad, that they existed. We had heard of them, but never really knew them. So as the years went by, and we had to put up with these services, in 1969, earlier before 1969, oh, I forgot to mention that another service that they had completely destroyed was the service of the elevation of the Holy Cross. In September, we elevate the Holy Cross. Well, the New Calvinist Church used this as an event to make a big show and to raise a lot of money. So instead of the ascension, the elevation of the Holy Cross, again, they would shut down all the churches. We'd go to the CNE and go to the main football arena where the Toronto Argonauts used to play and do a liturgy there. There would be a priest assigned at every gate to sprinkle people that came in with holy water, and of course a tray to collect money, because money was very, very important. And at the end of the liturgy, everybody would get together, we'd go down to the harbor, get onto a little boat with usually the Anglican Archbishop of Toronto on that boat, and go out into the lake to not elevate the cross, but to sink the cross, throw the cross into the water, because this was a very showy thing. So here we are in September, people jumping into the lake, retrieving the cross, and so forth and so on. I did that. So many years have passed. I felt like a traitor. As I was crossing this big field of the CNE, going to the parking lot to go with my car, because I wouldn't let Presidetta come. I had handled this all by myself. I ran into a bunch of young men. I think Father Luke was there. Seraphim was there. God rest his soul. Bimuseni was there. Michael Maragulis, the pharmacist, was there. Ilya, our first chanter, was there. And Father Nectarius, who back then Nico, Father Damaskinos, who back then was, I forget his worldly name, Dimitri Tsapralis, yeah. And I don't remember how many other. And as I was crossing, this gang of guys approached me and they said, "We need a father confessor." No one had ever said anything to me about confession. I didn't even know what confession was about. Well, I bonded with these young men. And we immediately, I derived strength from them. We would started doing Vesper services every Saturday. And after the Vesper services, we would sit down and have classes together. Meanwhile, a group of women approached, and we formed at St. Demetrius. I was a priest at St. Demetrius at that time. We formed the Sisterhood of St. Nectarius at St. Demetrius. We purchased an icon of St. Nectarius and set up a icon stand and started doing the supplicatory canon to St. Nectarius on Wednesdays. Started doing Vespers, started doing vigil services. And when I say vigil services, they lasted all night and we would do the liturgy in the morning when sun broke. And people would come. And St. Demetrius was, as you might know, it was a large church, would fill with people who came to these services to be blessed. Meanwhile, the local bishop and the clergy would make fun of us. I remember once, it was a Wednesday night, and I was late for a clergy meeting, and the bishop sarcastically said to me as I walked in, "Welcome, Father Panayotis. Did you grease them up pretty good?" They mocked us. St. Nectarius was, an icon of St. Nectarius was not allowed in any church in Toronto. There wasn't one church that would even allow it. So people tried to bring the icon to the churches. The priests would say, "No, we don't accept this icon." Toreleme, για τα χρόνια αυτά που ο οικουμενισμός είχε φέρει μεγάλη αλλαγή στο Τορόντο. Το 1966 όταν έφτασα εδώ στο Τορόντο, δεν είχα πείρα καθόλου από την ζωή, γιατί όλα τα χρόνια μου ήμουν στο θρανείο. Και πρώτη φορά που γνώρισα ανθρώπους από κοινωνικής πλευράς ήταν εδώ στο Τορόντο που γνωρίστηκα με ανθρώπους. Και το Τορόντο τότε, το 1966, ήταν για τους Έλληνες ήταν ένα μεγάλο πρόβλημα. Όλοι νεοφερμένοι, σοβαρά προβλήματα, πολλές αυτοκτονίες τότε, τα χρόνια αυτά τα θυμάμαι. Μεγάλη απεπαισία, διότι ήταν δύσκολα χρόνια που πολλές γυναίκες ήρθανε απλώς να δουλέψουν σε ξένα σπίτια, μικρές κοπέλες, 16, 17, 18 χρονών. Άλλοι ερχόντουσαν σε συγγενείς που δεν ξέρανε καλά. Νέα ζευγάρια που ερχόντουσαν από την Ελλάδα με μια βαλίτσα μόνο και προσπαθούσαν να βρουν πού να μείνουν. Σε ένα σπίτι υπήρχαν 26 άντρες, ένας από τους οποίους ήταν ο δικός μας ο Μακαρίτης, ο πατέρας Αλέξανδρος, που δουλεύανε και κοιμόντουσαν σε βάρδιες. Γιατί με 24 άτομα μόνοι τους δουλεύανε να πληρώσουν τον οίκιο για να νοικιάσουν το σπίτι. Πολύ δύσκολα. Οι περισσότεροι Έλληνες, και τότε όπως είπαμε υπήρχαν και πολλές αρρώστιες και αυτοκτονίες και είχαμε είχα να συναντήσουμε ανθρώπους που εγώ δεν είχα πείρα καθόλου από την ζωή, εκτός εγώ ήξερα βιβλία, διάβαζα. Όταν ήρθαμε εδώ και πήγαμε, είδαμε ότι και εκκλησίες δεν ήταν εκκλησίες. Δεν είχαν τις ακολουθίες. Καμιά εκκλησία δεν έκανε τον Εσπερινό ποτέ. Τους Αγίους σχεδόν τους είχαν ξεχάσει. Τα μυστήρια, γάμοι, βαπτίσεις, γινόντουσαν το 1/3 από τα λόγια, δηλαδή στους βαπτίσεις, τους εξορκισμούς, τους κόβανε τελείως. Από τους γάμους, ευχές, πράγματα. Και αυτό το βλέπαμε και με μεγάλη στενοχώρια βλέπουμε πού είχε καταντήσει η κατάσταση. Είπαμε, η εικόνα του Αγίου Νεκταρίου δεν υπήρχε πουθενά, κανένας δεν ήθελε να ακούσει για τον Άγιο Νεκτάριο. Και τότε αρχίσανε και βγάλανε νόμο ότι το Πάσχα, υπήρχαν 4 εκκλησίες με το νέο μυρολόγιο τότε, ότι σε καμία εκκλησία δεν θα γίνει Πάσχα, αλλά θα γίνεται το Πάσχα στο Maple Leaf Gardens, το οποίο ήταν το κέντρο για το hockey τότε στα χρόνια αυτά. Και όλοι πηγαίναμε για μια κοροϊδίστικη ακολουθία, στην οποία ανεβάζανε τις τιμές στα κεριά 10 φορές παραπάνω από ό,τι ήτανε, περνούσανε 3 δίσκους, έβγαινε ο δεσπότης, έβγαινε ο πρόεδρος της κοινότητας και μας έλεγε όλους, όταν ρίχνετε χρήματα δεν θέλουμε να ακούμε κέρματα. Και έπειτα ο κόσμος κοροϊδίστηκε, έφυγε και λέγανε αυτό ήταν το Πάσχα. Έπειτα το Σεπτέμβριο, άλλη κοροϊδία, όλα αυτά για να καταστραφεί η Ορθοδοξία, στην γιορτή της Υψώσεως του Τιμίου Σταυρού, καταργήσανε την γιορτή της Υψώσεως και δεν γινόταν ύψωση στις εκκλησίες, αλλά στην Κυριακή όλοι πηγαίνουν πάλι στο CNE, στο κέντρο εκεί, στο μεγάλο θέατρο, στο μεγάλο πέδιο στάδιο, το πέδιο στάδιο εκεί που παίζανε τότε ποδόσφαιρο. Γινόταν μια ψεύτικη λειτουργία και έπειτα βάζανε σε κάθε είσοδο έναν παπά με λίγο αγιασμό και μια γυναίκα από τη Φλόπτο να μαζεύουμε χρήματα. Φεύγοντας από εκεί πηγαίναμε κάτω στη λίμνη, μπαίναμε πάνω σε ένα καράβι. Ήταν και μαζί ο αρχιεπίσκοπος των Αγγλικανών. Βγαίναμε έξω στη λίμνη. Και αντί να υψώσουνε το σταυρό που ήταν ύψωση του σταυρού, πετάγανε το σταυρό μέσα για να γίνεται ρεκλάμα, για να βλέπει ο κόσμος, για να διασκεδάζει. Πνευματικότητα, δηλαδή, σίγουρα σχέδια του σατανά να καταστραφεί η Ορθοδοξία. Θυμάμαι η πρώτη φορά που το έκανα αυτό, πόσο απελπισμένος ήμουνα. Ξέχασα να σας πω ότι λίγο πριν από αυτό, γιατί όταν χειροτονήθηκα και ήρθα στο Τρόνο του 1966, Είχα γένεια, είχα ράσα, είχα ένα κομποσκινάκι. Και ο δεσπότης στο Τρόντο και οι παπάδες όταν είδαν έτσι όλοι τα χάσανε και διαμαρτυρηθήκανε. Τελικά καταφέραμε τον Αρχιεπίσκοπο στην Αμερική να με γράψει ένα γράμμα και να με πει ότι αν δεν συμμορφωθώ μέχρι της Παναγίας που γιορτάζω δεν θα επιτρέπεται να ξαναλειτουργήσω. Και εγώ με μεγάλη στενοχώρια, λυπημένος, ξυρίστηκα, έβγαλα τα ράσα, έκρυψα το κομποσκίνι και με άρχισε τότε μια μεγάλη απελπισία. Ήταν σε μέρες αυτές που γνώρισα, πρώτα μου γνώρισα τον πατέρα Λουκά, την αδελφή του η Κωνσταντίνα, τον πατέρα του, ο Βαγγέλης που αργότερα έγινε πατήρ Ξενοφώνη, η μάνα του κυρία Δήμητρα, ο αδελφός ο Βασίλης, ο Γιάννης. Γνώρισα όλη την οικογένεια αυτή την εποχή του 66 και άλλους κατατοπλίζουν νέοι άνθρωποι που... και εκεί στο κατηχητικό είχαμε και μια κοπέλα που ήταν από την Αθήνα, δεν θυμάμαι το όνομά της. Αυτή είδε τι τραβούσε και είχε ένα πνευματικό δεσμό με την Μακαρίτισσα, την ηγουμένη της Μονής Αγία Ειρήνη Χρυσοβολάντου, μητέρα Μελετία που ίδρυσε το μοναστήρι της Αγίας Ειρήνης Χρυσοβολάντου. Και έγραψε αυτή η κοπέλα ένα γράμμα στην γερόντισσα να της πει τι έγινε και έλαβα εγώ προσωπικά γράμμα από τη μητέρα Μελετία να με ενθαρρύνει και να με εύχεται να γυρίσω μια μέρα με το παλιό. Που εγώ ιδέα δεν ήξερα τι ήταν το παλιό. Στην Βοστόλη που ήμασταν είχαμε μια μικρή εκκλησία που ήταν με το παλιό, αλλά όλοι ξέραμε ότι αυτοί οι παλιμονίδες ήταν όλοι τρελοί και τους αποφεύγαμε. Δεν είχαμε καμία επαφή με τρελούς ανθρώπους. Έτσι ξέραμε τι ήταν το παλιό. Τώρα πρώτη φορά ακούω, αλλά φαίνεται με μπήκε κάτι μέσα και άρχισε το σκουλίκι να δουλεύει. Και αργότερα όταν αρχίσαμε να αντιδρούμε στις αλλαγές αυτές που φαίνανε στις εκκλησίες, έπειτα από μια τελετή εκεί στο CNE, πολύ πολύ απελπισμένος, αισθανόμουν σαν να είχα προδώσει τον Χριστό μας, ότι ήμουν προδότης. Και πήγαινα, θυμάμαι, σε ένα χωράφι εκεί, πήγαινα εκεί που ήταν το αυτοκίνητο, στο parking lot, να πάω σπίτι. Την πληροφορία δεν την άφηνα να δει πουθενά σε τέτοια πράγματα. Και ξαφνικά μια ομάδα από 6-7 άντρες, ήταν ο Σεραφείμ, ο θείος του Ηλίας, ο Νίκος, ο Δημοσθένης, ο Μιχάλης ο φαρμακοποιός, ο Πάτερ Λουκάς νομίζω, με συναντήσανε και ήρθανε και με πλησιάσανε και μου είπαν θέλουμε να έχουμε ένα πνευματικό πατέρα. Αναλαβαίνεις εσύ να μας εξομολογήσεις? Εγώ δεν είχα ακούσει ποτέ για εξομολόγηση. Δεν ξέραμε για εξομολόγηση. Εξομολόγηση δεν ήξερε κανείς. Ο Άγιος Δημήτριος, που ήταν η μεγαλύτερη ενορία στον Καναδά τα χρόνια αυτά, δεν έρχονταν ποτέ κανείς να εξομολογηθεί. Δεν ήξερε κανείς. Τώρα, όταν ήρθαν οι νέοι αυτοί, και εγώ απάνω χάρηκα τόσο πολύ που τους γνώρισα. Που συγκινήθηκα και σχηματίσαμε μια μικρή ομάδα. Εν τω μεταξύ, με κάτι κυρίες εκεί στον Άγιο Δημήτρη, σχηματίσαμε την αδελφότητα του Αγίου Νεκταρίου. Φέραμε την εικόνα του Αγίου Νεκταρίου, φτιάξαμε ένα προσκυνητάρι και αρχίσαμε να κάνουμε τις παρακλήσεις, Τετάρτη βράδυ. Και να μυρώνουμε τους χριστιανούς με Άγιο Λαδάκι από την Καντήλα, το οποίο δεν γινόταν ποτέ. Το λάδι της Καντήλας δεν το ήξερε κανείς. Το ξέρανε τα χωριά τους, αλλά στο Τρόντο είχε σβήσει αυτή η τάξη. Αλλά ο δεσπότης της Τρόντο και όλοι οι κληρικοί κοροϊδεύανε. Θυμάμαι κάποτε, Τετάρτη βράδυ είχαμε και συγκέντρωση κληρικών και επειδή ήθελα να κάνω εγώ την παράκληση και να πάω έπειτα, πήγα λίγο αργά στη συγκέντρωση, μπαίνοντας μέσα, λέει ο δεσπότης δυνατά, καλωσορίστωνε τον πάτε Παναγιώτη, τους λάδωσες καλά καλά. Κοροϊδεύανε και γελάσανε όλοι, γιατί λαδώνω τους χριστιανούς. Αλλά με αυτό το λαδάκι, με τις αρχίσαμε αρτοκλασίες, αρχίσαμε σπυρινούς, αρχίσαμε μαθήματα, αρχίσουμε τις ακολουθίες. Σιγά σιγά ερχόντουσαν ο κόσμος. Είχαμε αγρυπνίες, και όταν λέω αγρυπνίες, αγρυπνίες βαστούσαν όλη νύχτα, το πρωί όταν έβγαινε ο ήλιος, τότε αρχίζουμε την λειτουργία.
Αυτό δεν είναι
το πρόβλημα για Δημήτρη. Στον Άγιο Δημήτρη. Από εκεί ξεκινήσουμε, γι' αυτό λέω. Και εκεί είχαν μαζευτεί αρκετοί άντρες και γυναίκες. Θυμάμαι τότε είχα ένα μικρό παιδάκι το οποίο με ακολουθούσε. Και μια βραδιά, νομίζω ήταν 10 ετών το παιδάκι αυτό, έμεινε όλη νύχτα στην αγρυπνία, χωρίς η μάνα του να ξέρει πού είναι το παιδί. Και αυτό ήταν στην εκκλησία. Αυτό το παιδί είναι ο Αποστόλης του Σιγάλας, που σήμερα είναι παππούς. Και έρχεται. Ήταν μαζί μου από 10 ετών παιδάκι. Τρεις κυρίες που βοηθήσαν πάρα πολύ είναι ο Σιμάκης απόψη με την Παρασκευή την ΠΑΜ, η μητέρα της ΠΑΜ και οι δύο θείες τους ήταν εκεί. Κυρία Αναστασία Γερούκη, η Ολίβια, η αδελφή της Αντωνίας που τότε την είχα σαν δεξί μου χέρι. Η μητέρα Φιλοθέη, μακαρίτισσα, που τότε ήταν η Ελένη Μπομπότση. Δεν είχε γίνει μοναχή ακόμα. Όλοι ήμασταν τότε στον Άδημι, ήταν ο Σταύρος, ο Μπάτσκος, ο Κλειάνθης με τα μικρά. Ο Σταύρος είχε τα δύο κοριτσάκια μωρά, μόλις 2-3 ετών. Και ερχόντουσαν, ήμασταν όλοι νέοι, οι παιδάκια. Οι περισσότεροι που ήμασταν στον Άδη Δημήτρη και είδαμε την χάρη και την ευλογία που δίνουν οι Άγιοι και οι ακολουθίες, ήσαν όλοι νέοι, ήσαν μερικά γεροντάκια, λίγα. Μία ήταν η μητέρα του πατρός Λουκά, η μακαρίτισσα, η Δήμητρα, η οποία τα χρόνια αυτά αρρώστησε με καρκίνο και την κηδέψαμε τότε στην εκκλησία, στην Παναγία, στο Richmond Street. Βάσταξε ο πόνος της, τα βάσανά της τόσο καιρό, στο νοσοκομείο που πηγαίναμε τακτικά να την κοινωνάμε. Ο πατέρας του, ο κ. Βαγγέλης, ο μπαμπα Λουκάς, ο Χρυστακάκος από την Σπάρτη, ο οποίος ήταν πολύ, πολύ παλέμαχος άνθρωπος, που για μένα ήταν πατέρας.
Μπαρμπαλιάς.
Όταν ήταν η οικογένεια του, όλοι πηγαίναμε το νέο. Και μια μέρα η κόρη του με κάλεσε στο σπίτι να κάνω ένα ευχέλιο στο σπίτι. Και πήγα εκεί και είχαν ένα δωμάτιο γεμάτο από εικόνες. Και μπήκα μέσα εκεί να κάνω το ευχέλιο και είδα ένα ημερολόγιο στον τοίχο, το οποίο φαινόταν παράξενο, διότι δεν έδειχνε την ημέρα, ήταν λίγο πίσω. Και ήταν ένα γεροντάκι το οποίο δεν έμπαινε στο δωμάτιο, καθόταν έξω. Ο Μπαρμπαλιάς. Και τελειώσαμε το ευχέλιο και η ζωή λέει στον πατέρα. Μπαμπά, αυτός ο παππούς τα έκανε σωστά. Λέει, θα δούμε αν είναι σωστός. Το καιρός θα το δείξει. Ήταν πολύ άγριος άνθρωπος. Ήταν από τους πρώτους που είχαμε. Η γιά η Χριστίνα, η Σκούλου. Η Δανάη με τον Γιάννη. Όλοι αυτοί. Είχαμε τα γεροντάκια αυτά. Τον παππού, τον Θανάση, τον Φλέντζαρη. Ο οποίος ήταν στην αρχή δεξί μου χέρι, σε όλα τα βαπτίσια, σε όλα τα μεσία, εκεί ήταν ψάλτης, νεοκόρος, ό,τι ήθελα ήταν εκεί να μου βοηθήσει. Και τώρα, σε λίγο θα παντευθεί ο Νίκος, που είναι δυσέγγονος, δυσέγγονος έτσι το λέμε, του Μπαρμπα Θανάση, του Φλέντζαρη. Τόσα χρόνια έχουν περάσει. Και έτσι ο Θεός μας είχε δώσει από τον Άγιο Δημήτρη καλούς ανθρώπους, οι οποίοι ενθαρρύνανε την πίστη. Και όταν ήρθε να κάνουμε το Πάσχα του 69, όλοι μαζί πήραμε απόφαση, δεν θα το κάνουμε. Στο Maple Leaf θα πούμε ότι αρρώστησε ο πατήρ Παναγιώτης και θα πάμε μυστικά στον Άγιο Δημήτρη να κάνουμε Πάσχα μόνοι μας, μια χούφτα άνθρωποι. Τώρα εμείς οι Έλληνες δεν ξέρουμε από μυστικά. Γέμισε, θα ήταν 1000 άτομα την βραδιά αυτά στον Άγιο Δημήτρη. Αμέσως έγινε, ξεσηκώθηκε ο επίσκοπος, η κοινότητα όλη. τα παλικάρια αυτοί που λέγαμε. Μήπως πάρε την οικογένεια και φύγει, πήγαινε στη Βοστόνη, κρύψου για μια εβδομάδα. Εμείς θα μείνουμε εδώ. Και ψάξανε να βρουν που ήταν ο Δεσπότης και τον βρήκανε στους Αγίους Πάντες. Ήταν μια κυρία που τότε πολλές Ελληνίδες δουλεύανε στα σφαγεία. Και αυτή είχε πάει μαζί της ένα σφυρί. Και όταν πήγε ο Δεσπότης να βγει από την πίσω πότα, να φύγει από την εκκλησία, όλοι τον περιμέναν εκεί. Και αυτή φώναζε και με το σφυρί, θα έχει θείαμα. Ο Μιχάλης τότε ήταν ο πιο λόγιος και ανάλαβε τον λόγο να μιλήσει και λέει με τον τρόπο που έχει ο Μιχάλης. Κάτσε κάτω δεύτερα, τόσο καιρό εμείς σε ακούμε, τώρα εσύ θα μας ακούσεις. Και βγάλουν η απόφαση ότι αν θα γίνει πνευματικό δικαστήριο να μην υποστεί καμιά τιμωρία. Από τότε το ΕΣΚΟΣ είπαμε δεν αντέχουμε πλέον. Και μας οδήγησε ο Θεός στην σύνοδο του Αγίου Φιλαρέτου. Και σχεδιάσαμε εμείς, οι κυρίες και οι άντρες, να νοικιάσουμε ένα λεωφορείο και μερικά που ήρθαν με γιοταχή, να πάμε στο μοναστήρι, το Τζόρνβιλ, που ήταν ο αρχιεπίσκοπος Αβέρκιος και άλλοι, για την τελετή της Πεντηκοστής που γιόρταζε το μοναστήρι, ή το μοναστήρι της Αγίας Τριάδος. Πήραμε μαζί μας την εικόνα του Αγίου Νεκταρίου και τα Άγια Λείψανα, το οποίο κατά θαυμαρικό τρόπο τα είχε φέρει ένας Παπαδημήτρης από την Σπάτη, ο οποίος είχε δει μεγάλο θαύμα από τον Άγιο Νεκτάριο. Μεγάλο θαύμα. Και ήρθε σε εμάς, διότι εμείς ήμασταν η μόνη εκκλησία που επιτρέπεται το όνομα του Αγίου Νεκταρίου να μνημονεύεται. Ήρθε και ο Παπαδημήτρης μαζί μας και πήραμε τα Άγια. Εκεί ο Αρχιεπίσκοπος Αβέρκιος μας δέχθηκε με αγκαλιά, διότι είχε μεγάλη ευλάβεια ο Αρχιεπίσκοπος Αβέρκιος για τον Άγιο Νεκτάριο. Και όταν είδαμε με τι σειρά, με τι τάξη, με τι ευλάβεια, τι αγιοσύνη γεννώντουσαν οι τελετές, όλοι πήραμε απόφαση πρέπει να φύγουμε από το οικουμενισμό και να ενταχθούμε σε αυτή τη Ρωσική Σύνοδο. Τότε μέρα της Πεντηκοστής πήραμε απόφαση και είπαμε μέχρι του Αγίου Νεκταρίου θα έχουμε φύγει και θα έχουμε ιδρύσει η Εκκλησία του Αγίου Νεκταρίου μέσα σε λίγες μήνες. I'm recanting how after all these events of watching the destruction of the Orthodox services and practices, God found a way, as we said at the beginning, God leads the ship. God found a way to lead us out of this catastrophic condition, which was very, very, great despair. How I met these young men, and then later a group of young women. And with the men, we formed the Brotherhood of St. Mark of Ephesus. And with the women, we formed the Sisterhood of St. Nectarius, started the supplicatory canons, started doing the vespers, the vigils, all the services. And then by 1969, determined that we were not going to go to Maple-Leaf Garden anymore for that blasphemous type celebration of Pascha. Just a handful of us decided, what we'll say is Father Panayotis is sick, he can't go to the service, and secretly sneak into St. Demetrius and do our own Paschal service. But Greeks are not good at keeping secrets. And what was supposed to be a secret church service, there were 1,000 people who showed up that night. More than 1,000. More than 1,000. He remembers. More than 1,000. Well, the next day, the bishop, the Greek community, everybody, they were up in arms. The people that had surrounded me, and this is from God, because as I said, I was not a people person, but people just surrounded me. They told me in prison, take the kids, go back home to Boston. We'll handle things until you come back. We'll tell you when to come back. And we left. They were quite strong-willed people. As I said, everybody was young. The spokesperson was Michael Maragulis, the pharmacist, who's again my age. He was just then a student, wasn't married. They found out where the Monday past Monday, they found out where the bishop was serving, All Saints Church in at Bayview. They went there, they surrounded the church, and the bishop tried to sneak out the back door. They met him at the back door. There was a lady there, quite a hefty young lady, and she had brought a hammer with her. And she picked up a hammer and started, she was Macedonian, by the way. Vodska. She picked up the hammer and she said, "Blood will be spilt." She worked at the slaughter yards, so she was used to spilling blood. Michael Maragulis said to the bishop, "Bishop, sit down. We've been listening to you all these years. Now it's your turn to listen to us." Well, they worked out some deal that, yes, there would be a spiritual court, but no punishment would be held. So when that, with that, our mind was made up. At that time, we had read the beautiful things St. Philaret had published. And so we decided to find out for ourselves, and we organized a group of people. We chartered a bus and maybe four or five automobiles, and we all drove down to Jordanville. And we attended their service on Holy Pentecost, which is their feast day. And we had never seen such a service, such piety, not only from the bishop, Archbishop Verki, and the clergy, but from the people. We thought we were in Disneyland or someplace, a church so beautiful. You have to understand, we were so deprived, and then all of a sudden thrown into Jordanville, what it did to us. I mean, Father Luke fell in love with Jordanville from that moment, and he was always driving back and forth. He even convinced the Consul General of Greece to go to Jordanville with him. Yeah, the Consul General of Greece at that time was on our side. He went to Jordanville with him. And so Father Luke was back and forth to Jordanville. And soon we wrote a letter to St. Philaret asking to be accepted into the synod. We replied, we received the blessing right away. We sent a letter to Archbishop Auxentius in Greece, received his blessing too. And we decided that by the Feast of St. Nectarius, we would have the new parish. It was a bit, I don't know, weird what I decided. Decided that we would have a vigil for St. Nectarius with the new calendar at St. Demetrius. And that's when I would announce what we were doing. Because I figured the people who come to a vigil, they're the ones who should hear. And within 2 weeks, we had to get the church, the new church, ready. At that time, we had come into contact already with the Russian Church abroad here in Toronto at Holy Trinity, Father Matthei and Father George Skrinnikov, who supported us immensely. They had a new church. But they also had an old church, which they themselves had built. It was a consecrated church, and it's a church, Panagia today, on Richmond Street. They didn't want to sell it or do anything to it because it was consecrated, so they left it abandoned. It was an abandoned building on Richmond Street. And they said to us, "You could use it, as you know, it's in pretty bad shape." And it was. It was in horrible shape. No water, no heating.
No floor.
So we had 2 weeks. Father Luke wasn't working back then. So he and I, we went to a bank. We got $1,000 loan from a bank manager that I knew. Because I had good credit rating as a Greek Archdiocese priest, because I had some money. So he gave us $1,000, which back then was a good amount. And with that $1,000, Father Luke and I rented a truck. We went and bought paint. We got lumber, we got scaffolding, we borrowed it from St. Demetrius. Borrowed it, yeah. Well, technically it was still my church, so. Another thing is, while at St. Demetrius, I had an assistant priest and I told him, "Father Constantine, please don't serve for a few weeks. I am going to start commemorating Metropolitan Philaret." And I did a lot of weird things. I started commemorating Metropolitan Philaret while I was still in the New Calendar Church. And Steve Patskos was in church, and the guy next to him turns and said, "Who's this Philaret?" After that, yeah. these things.
The first time you did it.
The first time. So commemorate St. Philaret for a few weeks at St. Demetrius. And since it was my parish, the people there were very, very helpful, as I said. So we borrowed their scaffolding and we returned it and a few brushes and things. And we were painting and fixing up with Father Luke. As I said, Panagia didn't even have a floor. There was no heating system, nothing. But for us, it was as if someone had given us a golden parish, a Taj Mahal. It was an amazing thing. It's filled with grace. We don't look at it as the difficult days, as the poor days. They were amazing days. And right away, miracles started. Όταν μπήκαμε στη νέα εκκλησία, όταν φύγαμε από τον Άγιο Δημήτρη, φύγαμε, είπαμε, πήραμε απόφαση την Αγία Πεντηκοστή και είπαμε του Αγίου Νεκταρίου με το νέο θα κάνουμε αγρυπνία στον Άγιο Δημήτρη και με το παλιό θα κάνουμε αγρυπνία στη νέα εκκλησία. Και είχαμε λίγο καιρό να ετοιμάσουμε την Παναγία. Είχαμε επαφές με τη Ρωσική Εκκλησία εδώ της Αγίας Τριάδας, με τον αείμνηστο πατέρα Μαθαίο και τον αείμνηστο πατέρα Γιώργιο Σκρίνικοφ, οι οποίοι πολύ πολύ μας βοηθήσαν και μας είπαν, εμείς τώρα έχουμε νέα εκκλησία, η παλιά εκκλησία είναι έρημη, αλλά αν θέλετε μπορείτε εκεί να λειτουργείτε. Αλλά η εκκλησία αυτή δεν είχε ούτε νερό, ούτε αποχωρητήρια, ούτε θέρμανση, όπως λέει και ο Σταύρος, δεν είχε ούτε πάτωμα καλά-καλά. Αλλά μπήκαμε μέσα και λες ότι κάποιος μας χάρισε ένα παλάτι. Με τέτοια χαρά μπήκαμε μέσα. Τότε ο πατήρ Λουκάς, νέο παιδί, ακόμα δεν είχε δουλειά, πήγαμε σε μια τράπεζα, ήξερα τον τραπεζίτη και μας δάνεισε $1,000 και με τα $1,000 αυτά νοικιάσαμε ένα φορτηγό, πήγαμε, αγοράσαμε ξυλία, μπογιές, ό,τι άλλο χρειαζόταν για να αρχίσουμε να βάφουμε σκαλοσίες, φέραμε από τον Άγιο Δημήτρη, αρχίσαμε και βάφαμε και φτιάχναμε με τον πατέρα Λουκά. Και ερχόντουσαν άλλοι να βοηθήσουν, αλλά κατά την πλήρη, εγώ και ο πατήρ Λουκάς δουλεύουμε εκεί, μέχρι να ετοιμαστεί η εκκλησία να γίνει η πρώτη αγρυπνία. Ένα θαύμα είναι ότι ο κόσμος στον τρόνο δεν γνώριζε ότι λειτουργεί νέα εκκλησία. Και το πρώτο θαύμα είναι ότι τότε μόλις φύγαμε, άνοιξε κάποιος μια εφημερίδα στο Τρόντο και δεν είχαν τι να πούνε για νέα και γράψανε για την ιστορία της νέας εκκλησίας. Πώς άνοιξε η νέα εκκλησία. Και βάλανε φωτογραφίες, βάλανε το κήρυγμα που είχα βγάλει, τυπώσανε και τις αντιδράσεις από τις ιερείς της Αρχιεπισκοπής και ο κόσμος στο Τρόντο έμαθε ότι υπήρχε νέα εκκλησία. Και γι' αυτό μέσα στην πρώτη αγρυπνία άρχισε αμέσως να η εκκλησία να γεμίζει. Και ο κόσμος με ενθουσιασμό ερχόταν. Διότι δεν γινόντουσαν εσπερινή και ακολουθίες. Εμείς όταν πρωτολειτουργήσουμε στο Richmond Street στην Παναγία, αρχίσουμε κάθε Άγιο να γιορτάζουμε με εσπερινό και θεία λειτουργία. Τόσο πολύ είχε γίνει αγαπητός ο εσπερινός που όλα τα μικρά παιδάκια ψένανε και έξω από τον Εσπερινό το πλουσίοι ευτόχευσαν και πείνασαν, διότι ήταν γεμάτο η εκκλησία από μικρά μικρά παιδάκια. Πολλές φορές ήταν τόσο πολλά μικρά παιδάκια που ήταν κίνδυνος να τα πατήσεις. Γεμάτη η εκκλησία, διότι είπαμε οι περισσότεροι ήταν νέα ζευγάρια. Είχαμε μερικά γεροντάκια, αλλά λίγοι, και αυτοί μας βοηθήσουν να κρατήσουμε την Ορθοδοξία. Με την ευλογία του Αγίου Φιλαρέτου, με την ευλογία του Αρχιεπισκόπου Αυξεντίου, του οποίου είχαμε τότε γράψει και πήραμε την ευλογία του να ιδρυθεί η ενορία, ξεκινήσαμε την εκκλησία και αμέσως αρχίσανε τα θαύματα. As soon as we started the services in the church, we started having so many miracles. One of the first miracles, as I said, was the one about the newspaper. Suddenly publishing for the first time and looking for something to write about, and they wrote about our parish, publish pictures, publish sermons and things like that. And it was right away people throughout Toronto learned about the parish of Toronto, of St. Nectarius. There were people who were told by St. Nectarius, I want you to go to my house, and were led on the TTC to the church. People came from everywhere, that not only the ones who left St. Demetrius, but all of a sudden people came from all other directions. Father Alexander, God rest his soul, was not part of the original group at St. Demetrius, because he had discovered the dangers of ecumenism before, and he was in the West End, and he had left with his family on his own and was going to the Russian church. And we met Father Alexander, his wife, Nectarius, and Father Alexander's parents at the Church of the Holy Trinity. They were going to the Russian church. As I said, if the Hebrews had not fled Egypt, they would not find the Prophet Mosiah. So Father Alexander is a young married man. Nectarius was barely walking, left Egypt to go into the Russian church. And the Greeks back then in the 60s were very, very patriotic. Very, very patriotic. It was unheard of. We were all labeled communists. We were all labeled rebels. We were all labeled unpatriotic. In fact, there was a right-wing group in Toronto that had a meeting, and they voted one day to come to our service and disrupt it and beat us all up. And I found this out from one of the members of this group, Costa Palanzas, who was a member of this group. He was very, very right-wing. And I said, Costa, how come you guys never come to beat us up? And he says, I don't know. we forgot about it. But who is this Costas? This Costas was, I'll tell you, I remember as it was yesterday. People never went to confession before the opening of the church. But when we started opening, there were so many people, there would be fights who would get ahead of the other person. So one day I was here upstairs listening to confession, and I heard a big turmoil outside. I said, oh, they're fighting again. So I went out to calm them down, and it wasn't a fight. It was Costa's wife, Maria, and his sister-in-law, Zoe, Barbalia's daughter, who were out there all upset because Costa, who was a foreman at a factory here in Toronto, was checking the conveyor belt at the end of the day, and his arm got stuck in the conveyor belt and was pulled out. They rushed him by ambulance to St. Michael's Hospital, which back then, as it is today, St. Michael's is a research hospital affiliated with the School of Medicine in Toronto. And the doctors there were always looking for experiments. So there was a doctor there and said to the police, where's his arm? The police said, well, we left it there. What are we going to do with his arm, you know? Go get it. So the police went all the way back to the factory, brought the arm wrapped in a towel, gave it to the doctor, and the doctor said, I'm going to try something. And he stitched it on to Costa. He said, the very worst. He said, if nothing happens, we'll just cut it off again. Doctors and their experiments. Well, Costa was awake. The surgery went well, but the arm was dead. Father Alexander, who was by that time a priest, went to see Costa at St. Michael's, had the icon of St. Nectarius with him, and he blessed Costa with the icon. And as he touched his hand, his arm, with the icon, Costa started screaming. He felt the icon touching him. He was so excited, he felt something. Well, he was a big man, and when he screamed. The whole hospital just came running and said, what's going on? And before you know it, the next day, Toronto Star had a big story on it with a picture of Costa and his arm. Of course, the Star didn't quite understand it. It said, a picture fell on it. They left out the part that was Father Alexander, that was an icon. But anyway, it made the Toronto Star. Well, this is Costa, who was a member of that right-wing gang that wanted to beat us up. He became, up until his last moment, he was a strong member of our parish. There are many, many miracles like that. There was a young boy, I think it was Kingston, Ontario. He fell and hit his head so badly, he was in a coma. His family asked for prayers from some family here in Toronto. They came to the church and we prayed for the little boy. As soon as we prayed, he came conscious. These miracles became very, very well known. there was a family in church. The youngest of their son had these horrible seizures. And when the parents knew that we got a seizure, they would do this and that, and he would sort of snap out of it. The father, back then a lot of the Greek men, owned trucks, and they were contractors for the city to do different contracting jobs. And it was fall, and it was getting, they were getting ready to do the snow plowing for Toronto. So he owned a truck. He had gotten it all set. And his son went into a seizure, but this time they couldn't stop the seizure. So Yorgo, God rest his soul, Yorgo said to himself, Saint Nectarius, heal my son, and I'll give you my truck. Well, at that moment, the young boy came to. The seizure stopped. George remembered his vow, and then he saw the first snowfall. He had everything. He said, well, maybe I'll work the truck one day, make a little money, then I'll give it to the church. It was all set. So he goes out to get the truck started to go on his contract. The truck wouldn't start. It wouldn't start. He realized his error, his sin, and he's vowed right away. He got on the phone and called me, Father Panayotis, come and get my truck. Oh my God, what am I going to do with a truck? What am I going to do with a truck? He says, I don't care what you're going to do with it. Take it. So we brought it and we parked it across the street from Panahia until we finally sold it. And that was, these and many, many other miracles happened at the beginning. And this is the grace of God steering the ship of our Lord towards the kingdom of heaven, bringing so many people. There's so many miracles that we can't possibly tell them all. Let me tell you, Odi Abdinarchi, Mosev Loyes, me bola bola thamada. Δεν είναι μόνο θαύμα πώς βρήκαμε την εκκλησία εκεί που σήμερα είναι η Παναγία, αλλά είδαμε τι μεγάλη βοήθεια μας είχε δώσει ο Χριστός. Τα χρόνια αυτά ήταν πολιτική ταραχή στο Τορόντο. Τότε υπήρχαν το Πασόκ, ο Πατακός και όλοι αυτοί και είχαν χωριστεί και μέσα στις εκκλησίες έρχονταν αστυνομία γιατί έδωσε την αίτημα να σφάξει τον άλλο μέσα στην εκκλησία. Και είχαν σχηματιστεί διαφορετικά σημεία. Ήταν ο Παπανδρέου, το κέντρο ήταν το Τερόντο. Του Πατακού, το κέντρο ήταν το Τερόντο. Και ένας από τα μέλη αυτά σε ένα σύλλογο που ήταν πολύ ζηλωτέ για τον Πατακό ήταν ο Κώστας ο Παλάντζας. Και είχαν σχηματίσει ένα σύλλογο. Και τότε όταν μάθανε ότι εμείς ανοίξουμε ενορία κάτω από τους Ρώσους, αυτοί είναι όλοι κομμουνιστές. Πρέπει να πάμε εκεί να τους κάνουμε ένα καλό μάθημα, να τους δώσουμε ένα γερό ξύλο. Γιατί αυτοί ξέρουν από ξύλο. Ο Κώστας ο Μακαρίτης ήταν χωροφύλακας. Πρέπει να τους δώσουμε ένα γερό ξύλο. Και έπειτα αργότερα, που όταν συναντηθήκαμε με τον Κώστα και έγινε πιστός μέλος, λέω: Κώστα, τι έγινε με αυτή την απόφαση που μου λες εσύ ήδη. Λέει, πάτε, δεν ξέρω. Ξαφνικά ο Θεός έβγαλε την απόφαση αυτό και την ξεχάσαμε. Τόσο είναι ο Κώστας ο οποίος έγινε μεγάλο θαύμα. Είπαμε ότι τα πρώτα χρόνια κανείς δεν εξομολογόταν. Έπειτα όμως, στην Παναγία του Άγιος Νεκτάριος, γέμιζε η εκκλησία από ανθρώπους να εξομολογηθούν και πολλές φορές τσακωνόντουσαν. Εσύ πήρε στη σειρά μου και έβγαινα έξω και τους έβαζα, περιμένετε λίγο και τους ησύχαζα. Μια μέρα εκεί που ξυμολογούσα γίνονταν μια μεγάλη ταραχή έξω. Βγαίνω έξω, λέω πάλι τσακωθήκαν οι γυναίκες. So, βγαίνω έξω, τι ήταν, η Μαρία, η γυναίκα του Κώστα και η νύφη του, η Ζωή, η Χριστακάκο, του Μπαρμπαλιά η κόρη και ήρθανε όλο ανασκαζόμενο, ήδη ο Κώστας που δούλευε, ήταν επεστάμενος εκεί σε ένα εργοστάσιο, πήγε να κλείσει μια μηχανή και η μηχανή άρπαξε το χέρι του και του τράβηξε και έκοψε ολόκληρο το χέρι του, το έβγαλε, το ξεκόλλησε. Τον πήγανε αμέσως εκεί στο Σέι Μάικλ στο νοσοκομείο, που είναι του Πανεπιστημίου νοσοκομείο και εκεί οι γιατροί είναι όλο πειράματα. Και ένας γιατρός λέει, θα το κολλήσω να δούμε τι θα γίνει. Το κολλήσανε το χέρι ξανά. Έστειλε την αστυνομία πίσω στο εργοστάσιο να φέρουν το χέρι, φαντάζομαι τώρα, πήγαινε πίσω μπρος, το κολλήσανε, τίποτα, το χέρι νεκρό. Ο Μακαρίτης ο πατήρ Αλέξανδρος πήγε να δει τον Κώστα στο νοσοκομείο και έφερε μαζί του την εικόνα του Αγίου Νεκταρίου. Και πήγε να τον σταυρώσει με την εικόνα και εκεί που τον σταύρωνε το χέρι του, ξαφνικά ο Κώστας, που ήταν μεγάλος άνθρωπος, έβγαλε μια φωνή, ξεσηκώθηκε όλο το νοσοκομείο. Αισθάνθηκε την εικόνα απάνω στο χέρι του. Τρέξαν όλοι να δουν τι είναι. Την άλλη μέρα το Toronto Star έγραφε με μεγάλη φωτογραφία, δείχνει τον Κώστα με το χέρι του, πώς έγινε καλά το χέρι του Αγίου του Κώστα. Αυτά και άλλα θάματα. Ήταν ένα παιδάκι στο Kingston που έπεσε, χτύπησε το κεφάλι του και έπεσε σε αφασία. Και δεν ήταν έτοιμο θάνατο. Μας πήραν τηλέφωνο το Kingston σε μια οικογένεια που ερχόντασαν στην Άγιο Νεκτάριο να κάνουμε προσευχή για το παιδάκι στον Άγιο Νεκτάριο. Μόλις κάναμε προσευχή, την ίδια στιγμή το παιδί έγινε καλά και έζησε. Ένα άλλο θαύμα. Στην ενορία μας είχαμε έναν κύριο Γιώργη Μακαρίτης, η μάνα του κυρία Παναγιώτα, που ο άνθρωπος τότε, όπως πολλοί Έλληνες τότε, είχαν φορτηγά, δουλεύανε για εργολαβικά. Αυτός δούλευε για το Τρόντο και καθάριζε χιόνια το χειμώνα. Και ήταν φθινόπωρος, είχε ετοιμάσει το αμάξι του, όλα έτοιμα, με το πρώτο χιόνι να βγει έξω, να βγάλει το ημεροκάμωτα του. Είχαν ένα παιδί, είχαν τρία παιδάκια. Το μικρό παιδί είχε πολλές φορές τον έπιαναν ταραχές και έπεφτε σαν νεκρό. Ξέρανε οι γονείς από εδώ από εκεί πώς να το συνεισφέρουν το παιδί. Μια μέρα άρχισε το παιδί να τρέμει και να πέφτει και να ουρλιάζει, δεν μπορούσαν να το συνεισφέρουν. Ο κύριος Γιώργης μέσα του λέει: «Άι Νεκτάρι, κάνε το παιδί μου καλά και θα σε φέρω το φορτηγό μου». Έγινε αμέσως το παιδί καλά. Ο Γιώργης όμως την άλλη μέρα χιόνισε. Όταν είδε το χιόνι, λέει ο Γιώργης: «Ας το δουλέψω μια μέρα να βγάλω ένα ημεροκάμματο». Βγαίνει ο Γιώργης έξω, του είχε ετοιμάσει όλα, έτοιμο, το βάζει μπρος, δεν έπαιρνε μπρος το αμάξι. Ο Γιώργης κατάλαβε την αμαρτία του και λέει: «Άι Νεκτάρι, θα σε φέρω το αμάξι μου αυτή τη στιγμή». Βγαίνει από το αμάξι, βάζει στο σπίτι, με παίρνει τηλέφωνο: «Πάτε Παναγιώτη, έλα να πάρεις το φορτηγό μου». Έχω αμήνω, τι έκανα εγώ με ένα φορτηγό. Το φέραμε εκεί στην Παναγία, το αφήσαμε εκεί στο δρόμο μέχρι που το πωλήσαμε. Δηλαδή κάτι τέτοια θαύματα, απίστευτα πράγματα γίνανε τα χρόνια αυτά και αμέσως ο κόσμος ένιωσε τη χάρη του Αγίου Νεκταρίου. Αλλά αν δεν ήσαν αυτοί οι πρώτοι χριστιανοί που να αγωνιστούν, να μπορούν να πάρουν το θάρρος, γιατί τότε φεύγοντας από το νέο μερολόγιο, ήμασταν όλοι, μας έλεγαν ρωσόφιλοι, ήμασταν όλοι κομμουνιστές, ήμασταν όλοι προδότες της Ελλάδος. Μας βλέπουν όλοι με το χειρότερο μάτι. Και πάλι όμως αρκετοί πήραν την απόφαση και μπαίνανε στην εκκλησία, ακούγανε τις ακολουθίες, τις αγρυπνίες, τα ψαλτήματα, και λαμβάνανε μια ευλογία και νιώθανε, καταλαβαίνανε τη χάρη από τις ακολουθίες. Γι' αυτό οι ακολουθίες της Εκκλησίας είναι τα πιο σπουδαία πράγματα που μπορούμε να έχουμε και πρέπει να τα κρατήσουμε. Ο Εσπερινός, οι παρακλήσεις, από εκεί ξεκινήσαμε. Αν αφήσουμε τους Εσπερινούς, αν αφήσουμε τις αρτοκλασίες, αν αφήσουμε τους Αγίους, τότε εμείς χάσαμε την πίστη μας και μπαίνουμε όχι στο καράβι του Χριστού, αλλά φεύγουμε σε ένα μικρό βαποράκι και θα πνιγούμε. Διότι η βάση της πίστης μας είναι οι ακολουθίες, είναι οι Άγιοι, από εκεί λαμβάνουμε την κατεύθυνση του Χριστού μας για να φτάσουμε την Βασιλεία των Ουρανών. Just to finish up, just to remember that my last final words are that we formed this parish on the basis of church services. That's the foundation of our parishes. We started with something simple: Vespers, supplicatory canons, vigils, liturgies for saints, veneration of saints. This is where we saw the grace of God coming to lead us into this promised land. This is what we have observed in the past that was the target of the, of ecumenism that Satan's target to destroy. And this is why in the New Calendar Church, the first thing that was destroyed were the holy services, the saints, and the mysteries. We can't follow that path. We must do the best to be at every Vespers that's possible, the best at every supplicatory canon, the best at every vigil. This is what is the fuel that drives the ship of Christ. And if we don't have this fuel, we will be forced to abandon ship and find a little rowboat and try and pedal on our own power, and we'll never make it anywhere. We've got more things to say, but what I think now is a good time, maybe, if anybody has any questions to ask.
Το
είπα το.
Πιο καθαρά. Όπως το είπες, θα είναι στα Αυτή είναι η βάση της Εκκλησίας.
Το είπα αυτό πριν.
Να το ακούσουμε καλά.
Το άκουσες.
Τα μισά.
Είπαμε ότι αυτή η δύναμη που είναι η κατευθύνιος δύναμη στο καράβι του Χριστού είναι οι ακολουθίες και οι Άγιοι. Ξεκινήσαμε, πραγματικά όσο σκεπτόμουν πώς ξεκινήσαμε, είδα ότι ξεκινήσαμε με τις ακολουθίες, με τους εσπερινούς, με τις αρτοκλασίες, με τις παρακλήσεις, με όλες τις ακολουθίες των όρθρων. Είχαμε, θυμάμαι τότε, τέτοια μεγάλο ζήλο που δεν ξέραμε το τυπικό, δεν είχαμε ιδέα. Και βλέπουμε στην Αγρυπνία πρέπει να ψάρει στα ανοιξαντάρια. Να που κανείς από εμάς δεν ξέραμε από τέτοια πράγματα. Τι είναι τα ανοιξαντάρια, δεν ξέραμε. Γιατί με το νέο δεν υπάρχουν αυτά τα πράγματα, έχουν σβήσει. Άσε να τα ψάλλουμε. Και ήταν μια καλόγρια στην Βοστόνη, καλύτερη η Μακαρίτησα, μητέρα Μαγδαλίνη, ο Θεσπόζη την ξέρει. Την παρακαλέσαμε, έλα μητέρα Μαγδαλίνη, να μείνεις εδώ στον τρόνο μαζί μας, θέλουμε να μάθουμε μερικά πράγματα. Και είχαμε tape recorder και ηχογραφούσαμε και έτσι μάθαμε με τον Ηλία και τους άλλους τα ανοιξαντάρια και αρχίζουμε και τα λέμε με στην εκκλησία. Τότε ακόμα νίκιαζα, διότι με την Πρεσβυτέρα δεν είχαμε πάρει απόφαση να φύγουμε από τον Τρόντο ή όχι, και έμεινε μαζί μου η μητέρα Μαγδαλίνη μέχρι που μάθαμε μερικά πράγματα και έπειτα ο Θεός μας έστειλε από τα Ιεροσόλυμα τον πρώτο ψάλτη, τον Αραούζο, που τα χρόνια αυτά οι νέοι αυτοί όλοι μέναν σε ένα σπίτι του Ηλία. Όλοι, ανήπαντροι όλοι. Δημοσθένης, Ηλίας, Μιχάλης, όλοι μέναν μαζί. Και ήδη ο Αραούζος έμεινε και αυτός και έτσι είχε βάλει σε μια σειρά να τους μάθει το τυπικό και να ψάλλωνε. Και τους έδινε όλους ένα τίτλο. Μέγα πρωτοσυγκελάριος, ο πατέρ Νικόλος Νικτάριος που ήταν Νίκος τότε, δεν ήταν ικανός ούτε να ψάρει, να κάνει τίποτα, αλλά έφτιαχνε καλούς καφέδες. So, ο Αραούζος τον έβγαλε άρχον καφεδάριος. Είχαμε και τελειά, σαν να ήμασταν μεθυσμένοι από την χαρά του Αγίου Πνεύματος. Και όλα από τις ακολουθίες και η ώρα μας ήταν πώς θα μάθουμε τις ακολουθίες. Γιατί εγώ είμαι ο παπάς, δεν ήξερα τι θα πει τυπικό. Δηλαδή στο νέο μυρό δεν υπάρχει το τυπικό. Σε στέλνει ο δεσπότης οδηγείς τι θα πεις. Τυπικό δεν υπήρχε. Δεν ξέραμε τι θα πει τυπικό. Δεν ξέραμε τι θα πει πεδάλιο. Δεν ξέραμε τίποτα. Άσχετα που ήμουν 10 χρόνια στο Θρανείο. Και πάλι όμως μας φώτισε ο Θεός με τέτοια όρεξη να τα μάθουμε όλα αυτά τα πράγματα. Γι' αυτό λέω ότι αυτά αν τα χάσουμε, χαθήκαμε και εμείς. I'm just going over how it was through the love of the holy services and the saints. You know, God revealed to us new saints, Saint Denis Chrysovalandro, holy feast of the protection of the Mother of God, which we never knew. Saint Fanurius became our second saint, and we never knew about Saint Fanurius. So many other saints, so many things. And yet, and it was because of the love for the services that all these things that were revealed to us. So we can't turn our backs on what we might see. It's just Vespers, or it's just a sacrament that we can't. No, it's not just. It's not just. This is the kernel of our faith, and if we don't nourish and take care of it, our faith will never blossom. Okay, I'm exhausted. We have any questions or anything? Father? Father Luke, do you have anything you remember? Father Luke, was there? Luke, do you have anything you remember? Father Luke was there.
Now I can't see
him. He was your moral compass.
Oh, he was something to make me laugh.
Yes, of course. That's what he's good for.
A couple of questions.
Yeah, okay.
You mentioned that in the New Calendar Church, they didn't recognize or commemorate St. Nectarios. So what was the inspiration for St. Nectarios to be the patron saint of the New Church?
There was a problem in my family, and I prayed to Saint Nectarios, and the problem disappeared. So I started not knowing much about Saint Nectarios. His name was just coming out. So I started reading and learning more. Those days we had the blessing of having contact with the monastery, we said, oh, Chuanville, where they had a great veneration for St. Nectarios because they knew Metropolitan Petros and the other old calendarists. But also, we had a great spiritual relationship with Father Pandeliwan and the Fathers of Holy Transfiguration Monastery, who were by our side every step. And we learned much about St. Nectarios from them. And there was a constant stream of automobiles, Toronto, Boston, Toronto, Boston, non-stop. I mentioned earlier, a young man who was about 10 years old, Apostolios Sigalas. Well, he grew up, he became a teenager, and he was able to travel, he would travel to Boston. And then he'd stay there maybe a week, like a lot of our young boys did. He'd come back, and every time he came back, he would point out my errors. You're not doing it right. He would find my faults. Because they were, for us, a compass. A lot of the chants today, now I can't come to church that much, and I can't see, but I listen to the services, and I hear the Artoclesia with the Kyrie. That's we got that from Boston. So much incense. We didn't have this incense growing up. I remember in Boston in the early 62, 63, I remember about that, with Father Haram was sitting down trying to figure out how to make incense. And we ordered from France a coffee grinder because the Americans didn't have coffee grinders back then. And we used a coffee grinder to start grinding up incense tears to make, and we sprayed it with incense. The chanting, Metropolitan Ephrem, with God rest his soul, Father Lazarus, my brother-in-law, Presbyterian's brother-in-law, who was a musician from the New England Observatory of Music. He and Metropolitan Ephrem would spend hours trying to learn the Byzantine and transcribing it into a European notation. So you see, these contacts. And then Jordanville, as I said, Father Luke was there almost once a month. I started going there regularly. I started teaching there, actually. So between these two monasteries, we had a lot of instruction. And we had a very, very holy Archbishop, Archbishop Vitali, who was zealous for the faith. And he loved all our people. And as I said, Greeks are very fanatic Greeks, quite chauvinistic. And yet, they all loved him. Everybody did. He couldn't speak Greek, they couldn't speak Russian, and yet there was this love affair. He would love to come to the parish. People would flock. He would come to our church council meetings. And one day, we were at a church council meeting,
we broke into an argument, which is not unusual, in front of the Archbishop. And the argument was something to do with Holy Unction service, whether we should let, we should allow to receive unction or not. And then afterwards we apologized to the Archbishop. He says, no, no, don't apologize. He says, I love this. You're talking about the faith. He said, other churches, we're going to talk about the roof, the plumbing. You people talk about the faith. So you see, these are factors that we had. And we had visitors from Greece coming to see us every so often. The holy icon, of course, Kustaya, came to our church and with Father Boris. And I would drive around with him. We'd go from house to house, bringing the icon to bless people's houses. There was so much. I remember once I was doing the baptism service, and St. Philaret walked in while I was doing the baptism service. So he was up here often. And the Russian people were really something for us to observe. And just by looking at them, going to church with them and watching them, their decor, how they behaved in church, was very, very inspiring. So God gave us a lot of instructors, a lot of instructors. And the number one thing that we had was our bookstore. People started reading. The Lives of Saints were the number one seller, and everywhere we'd read all the Lives of Saints. Before you know it, we started ordering the great Synaxaristi. He says, now I'm telling the truth. What? Okay, anything else? Yeah.
Sorry. Just a follow-up question. Yeah. You briefly mentioned Father Alex's start to in his involvement in the church. And how did Father George get involved? What?
Well, the parish, with all these miracles, right, we opened our doors in November 1969 with the miracles and the zeal of the people. The parish grew so quickly. And Panagia at that time was an abandoned building. It was all cement block, inside and out. The walls would run with water from the people's perspiration. There's so many people. Unbelievable. So we realized we have to do something about this. We had all these children. We started having church school in the church itself. God rest his soul, Mother Philothea, back then Eleni. She was the first church school teacher. We'd pull up the benches and we'd have the church school. But we outgrew that soon. So while all those people coming, the church started financially standing on its own. And we had accumulated a certain amount of money, and with God's guidance, we bought a building on Pape Avenue that was a two-story building plus a basement, and it had two storefronts. We used this for church school classes, Greek school classes, meetings, banquets, a bookstore, and downstairs candle making in the basement. Candle makers were two people. This is the Naisundas and myself. Father Luke, by that time, had gone to the monastery, sent us some frames, and told us how to make the candles. And we would, the Nai and I would dip them. It was the women would sell it, and that way we would help the poor. So we purchased a building right away, as soon as possible. And started having a church school. We God again brought to us from Greece a young man who was very zealous and became the first Greek school teacher. And he just fell in love with his church, the children and everything, and did an excellent job. Mother Nectaria, I was looking at some pictures the other day, because if I was in better shape, I would have shown you old pictures. I found a picture of Mother Nectaria and Jenny and a few, and Petrula, as Greek school students at some other things we put on, because we started putting on Greek holidays, you know, for the 25th of March and everything. And so right away, under the guidance of that first church council, we were able to economize. We didn't pay people to do things. Everybody came and volunteered to do the work. As Stavra said, the floor was rotten. We put in a new floor one night. I remember, God rest his soul, Maria de Mussini's wife, on the floor with a hammer, pounding away the nails, you know. We installed a new floor in one night, so they would be ready the next day. So we did all the work ourselves, the plumbing, the heating, the The first winter was rough because there was no heating, so I had one fan heater in the sanctuary to sort of warm me up a little bit, but it was cold. But once people came, the church warmed up. So it didn't take us long to accumulate a certain amount of money. And even though we bought that building and paid, we were growing so fast that we started looking for churches. And we realized that Father George, Father Alexander and I, we couldn't handle the spiritual needs of the people. I'm telling you, I was a pastor, the rector of the largest parish in Canada, in the Greek Archdiocese. I was bored stiff. So finding things to do, I became a chaplain at the mental hospital. We used to call it 999, it's called now. CAMH, yeah, they changed the name. And I would go there with Mike Maragoulis and visit the different people. I would go to different hospitals. I would go out with my parishioners for lunch every day, different restaurants. I had nothing to do. Nobody came to church, nobody wanted confession, nobody wanted anything. They just wanted to come and socialize. So the priests really didn't have anything to do. There were so many people in the church who said to me, didn't even know who I was. Because you couldn't, you know. So now though, the spiritual demand, you sort of wonder, where did this demand come from? All these people wanting confession all the time. I remember one guy came to confession for his first time in many years. 5 hours I was with him. 5 hours to hear his first confession. 5 hours, I was exhausted. So they were all coming and unloading unbelievable sins, even up to homicide, unbelievable things. And where did this come from? And so Father Alexander and I, we couldn't handle it. There was two of us. Father Alexander was actually doing things that a clergyman should have been done before he was even a clergyman. He was a man, Strati, Muraitidis, God rest his soul. He had a very, very bad heart condition, and I think it was our second vigil for nativity at the church on Richmond Street. And he was passing away. And we heard that he was at his end. Father Alexander he was an ecclesiarch. He was helping me in the sanctuary. He was also our first treasurer. So I called him over and I whispered to him, I said, take the Holy Communion, hide it under your jacket, don't let anyone see you, go to the hospital and give Holy Communion to Strati. God rest his soul. Father Alexander did that and the man received Holy Communion, not from a clergyman, from a layman. And you know, this is what our people wanted, but we still, not to scandalize people, we kept it a secret. So that's how busy we were. We couldn't visit people. Everybody wanted to be visited. Everybody wanted hospital calls. So when we realized that we had to get another church, we couldn't abandon the old church because it was a consecrated church. So we figured two priests could not handle the two churches. We needed a third priest. And I had met Father George when I was in Thessaloniki. He was a student. I went there for my doctors to defend it. And he was there to greet me. And we became very close from that moment. Later, Father George became ordained. He got married, ordained. I went to Boston and baptized Elizabeth. So we maintained this bond. And then I asked the bishop and everybody else, I said, we need Father George here because he was fluent in Greek, fluent in English. He had his theological degree. We needed somebody. And he came with his family. It was difficult, but he came, drove all the way from Gary, Indiana, to Toronto, established here, and within a few months, December, we started liturgizing here at this church, which again was another abandoned church that we had to work on and fix up. And over the years, slowly but surely, with great financial difficulties, in 1 year, 1976, we purchased St. Nectarius, we bought Panagia from the Russian church, and we bought Prophet Elias, got ourselves into a horrible debt, but with the grace of God, we are now not only debt-free, but cash positive. So that's why Father George was here from 76 until he reposed. And you see, without Father George and without Father Alexander, each one having their own personality, contributing very, very much from their own spiritual life, it helped shape the parish into what it is. It was what was needed, this combination, at the beginning especially, because everyone had their own way of confessing, everyone had their own way of dealing with problems, and this is what this parish needed, because we had such a diverse group. And you know, the people who left the Greek chauvinism behind amazed me, because as non-Greeks started joining the parish, they were embraced with love. One of the greatest things that we have is how God brought us Peter Raymond. Operations embraced him. A few of them had some problems because there was an odor about him, there was this and that. And yet the majority welcomed him, and this was his home. And he was baptized, and it became his home. So then we see over the years, the nature of this parish has changed so that our bishop is not Greek. Father Savas is sort of Greek. Father Jeremy, he's as Celtic as he can get. He's a Celt. And who knows what? Look at Father David, Father Sergeant. When Father David and his presbyter first came here, because they could hear the building, they wondered if I could speak English. And then when they heard my Boston accent, they freaked out. They couldn't believe it, because Father David's also from Boston. So the history of this parish is one that has nothing to do with human endeavor. It was all our Lord and Savior guiding and assisting with the saints. We can never overlook what we owe to the saints for the formation of this parish. And this is why we have to keep up the blessing of the five loaves for as many saints' days as we can. Never leave a saint day go by without the blessing of a loaf. Somebody, at least one family, should make sure that there is five loaves. The prosperous classes, which Father Pariskevas has started, they have to continue. Growing up, and even in Greece today, even some old calendar churches, they buy their prosperity from a bakery. It's not the same blessing. The blessing from a family that makes a prosperity, signs it with the sign of the cross, and brings it in their own wrapping to the church, and then takes back the elevation. That blessing is not just for that family, it's a blessing for the whole parish. So the activity of one person, the activity of one family, spreads throughout the whole parish. So we can't stop these things. We have to maintain it. This is why it's so important for us to have olive oil for the vigil lamps. Sure, we can go. And I went to Jerusalem. I couldn't believe it. All the lamps were with electricity. Well, the lamps are not just a light. They're a blessing. The light they give forth is the grace of God to us. And when we look at a vigil lamp burning, we receive that Fors Christus, light of Christ shines on all, we say. The light, Fors Christus feni passi. We can't forget this, that the light of Christ shines. We just have to open our hearts and our eyes to receive the light. That's what sanctification is about, opening up to receive the grace of God. The grace of God is there. It's us who are blocking it. So if we turn our backs on Vespers, the services, vigils, then we are shutting in the door for the grace of God to enter in our souls. Αν σταματήσουμε τις παρακλήσεις, τους εισπυρινούς, αρτοκλασίες, τα καντήλια να τα ανάβουμε, να φτιάχνουμε τα πρόσφαιρα, να κάνουμε ό,τι κάνουμε για την Εκκλησία, τότε θα κλείσει η καρδιά μας και δεν θα μπορεί η χάρη του Θεού να μπει μέσα στην καρδιά μας, γιατί μόνοι μας κλείνουμε την καρδιά μας και λέμε στον Χριστό μας, δεν σε θέλω, θέλω κάτι άλλο. We can't turn to our Lord and say, I want something different, I don't want you.
Μάνος,
I can't see.
Είπες, Πάτερ, για τις ακολουθίες και που μαθαίνατε τα πρώτα χρόνια και σας ένωσε όλους και αυτά. Τι έχεις να πεις ειδικά για τους νέους και στα αγγλικά για να ακούσουν οι νέοι πώς μπορούμε να μαθαίνουμε περισσότερα, να τα διατηρήσουμε αυτά, to continue these things.
Okay, say that in English, and let the Metropolitan Father Savas and Father Pariskevas answer you, because my future is not doing that anything. Repeat in English.
So, you know, Father Panayotis said about the founding of this church and the services and learning about the services and how I've heard from a number of the first parishioners how that bonded everyone and learning and brought that, and people were thirsty for this. What message does the clergy have for the young people, especially, to learn more so that we can continue these things?
Let me answer that.
You please.
The first step is to, when you come to church, as you have, to come up onto the chanter stand and to just physically be next to the other chanters and whatever portions of the service they give you, because we can study the services in the abstract outside of the reading them in the books, which I've done with a few people, but it's not the same as actually like practical. Even when people study to be nurses and doctors, they study the theory, and then there's the practical aspect of it. So the first thing is to actually be on the chanter stand next to the other chanters and slowly picking up the oral tradition, which is handed down from one generation to the next. Η απάντηση σε αυτή την ερώτηση είναι οι άνθρωποι που θέλουν να μαθαίνουν τις ακολουθίες να παρευρεθούν στις ακολουθίες, όχι μόνο στο εκκλησίασμα, αλλά και πάνω στο ονολόγιο. Για πρώτη φορά να ακούνε τους άλλους, να βλέπουν τα βιβλία και ούτω καθεξής, διότι αν και έχω διδάξει ανθρώπους από τα βιβλία, εκτός από την ακολουθία, είναι ναι μεν η θεωρία του τυπικού, είναι το ένα πράγμα, αλλά το άλλο είναι το πρακτικό. Να είναι ο άνθρωπος επάνω στο ονολόγιο και έστω και να πει ένα πάτερ ημών. Αλλά φυσικά να είναι πάνω στο ονολόγιο, να ζήσει τις ακολουθίες στο ονολόγιο και πώς γίνονται οι ακολουθίες και σιγά σιγά να μπαίνει στο νόημα, όπως λένε, του ψάλσιμου. Και δεν είναι ανάγκη να έχει ο άνθρωπος φωνή, αλλά και χρειάζεται διάβασμα. Έχουμε πολλά διαβάσματα προφαντός στον όρθρο και δεν είναι ανάγκη να είναι μουσικός. Also, there are many readings that are to be done, and it's not necessary for the person to have a talent of chanting, but everyone can read, so it's we need, this is of course open only to men, but we need even people that can't chant, or of course they may be embarrassed initially to chant. Reading is something we can all do, and it's something we need, because we have the people that chant, and if they're reading, they get tired. By the time the liturgy starts, the chanters are tired from the three-hour orthros.
Also, I think that at home we should chant and listen to chanting. And when we're in church, as the chanting is going on, within ourselves, chant.
Together.
Not loudly to disrupt people, and that way you learn the services. How many people, when the holy gifts come out and we chant the cherubic hymn, actually say those words to themselves and listen to what they're saying? The words have great grace. Going back to history, as I said, we had a lot of young children in the churches, and we would go to homes a lot. We would celebrate all the saints. And there was one home, in particular, we go to Father Pariskevas' house. And it was time to eat, so we get there to bless the table, and we would start. One hymn after the other, then Mukumeni, Father Pariskevas would come up with another hymn, another. Father Pariskevas' grandfather would lose his patience and say, "Hey, it's enough. We're time to eat." She would all, we now, but you know what? That's all her children, that's how they learned. At home, they chanted these hymns. They chanted them at home. And then when they came to church, as I said, I was amazed at how all our little children learned the hymns. And that's how you learn the hymns, by coming to church, taking part, and then those who are able
we'll get more involved with the active in the Psaltiri. But I think that a lot of it has to do with our own love for the hymns, not just chanting, but paying attention to what are we saying, the words. And we will find that the hymns all bear such grace-bearing grace, that blessing, that these hymns will become part of us. They will become part of us. I can still remember the first time I ever heard Fosilaron. I know, you'll always say, first time? Yeah, first time. It was not chanted anywhere because there were no Vespers, so who ever heard Fosilaron? I think I was about 20 when I first heard Fosilaron. And this one. Anything else? Louder.
To bring it to the present, how would you gauge the strength of, you know, what you began and what it's become, you know, in terms of the genuine Orthodox, and what its place is now as a, you know, as a rock against, you know, the machinations of this, you know, current onslaught against the truth. So what, you know, how are we doing in that sense?
What are you saying?
How are we doing, like, just compared from the beginning until now?
Yeah. I mean, are we gaining momentum?
Are we gaining momentum?
Are
more
coming to understand what is going on the other side and what you're trying to do?
I see that in some ways we are gaining momentum. Some things we have lost.
Υπήρχε μια ζεστασία στην Εκκλησία, μια πίστη. Δεν ξέρω πόσοι θυμόσαστε, όταν κάποιος ήταν άρρωστος, ερχόταν στην Εκκλησία και έπεφτε κάτω στο κέντρο για να περάσουν τα Άγια Δώρα πάνω του στη Μεγάλη Είσοδο. Υπήρξε ένα κοριτσάκι, Καλομήρα, την λέγανε. Σήμερα είναι παντρεμένη παιδιά, που είναι και γιαγιά, 10 ετών. Οι γιατροί βρήκανε τρύπα στην καρδιά της και την είχαν κανονίσει για μια εγχείρηση. Οι γονείς της Καλομήρας φέραν το κοριτσάκι, το βάλαν κάτω, το στρώσαν εκεί, πέρασαν πάνω με τα Άγια και μετά λέω ότι γίνεται, με εξηγήσαν. Αυτή είναι η ομάδα, κάνουμε την εγχείρηση. Δώσα, κάναμε σέφιες. Την άλλη Κυριακή, να εγωνείς με την Καλομήρα πίσω στην Εκκλησία. Τι έγινε, υπάρχει, πήγαμε εκεί, κάναν εξετάσεις γιατί και είχε φύγει τρύπα.
Και τα έχουμε ξεχάσει. Πόσος κόσμος έπεφτε συνέχεια εκεί μπροστά για να περάσουν τα Άγια Δώρα πάνω.
Στο Ευαγγέλιο.
Στο Ευαγγέλιο. Ένα άλλο. Αν θυμόσαστε. Και βλέπεις τώρα, αυτά τα χάσαμε. Ο κόσμος είχε τέτοια πίστη που όταν κάνανε ένα παιδάκι, το τάζανε στον Άγιο Νεκτάριο και το φέρνανε στην εκκλησία, το ρίχνανε στην εικόνα και έγινόταν καυγά, θα τρέξουν όλοι να πάρουν το παιδί να το βαπτίσουν. Ο Βασίλης Κωστάρας είναι εδώ απόψε, Κωστάρας Βασίλης. Έτσι βαπτίστηκε ο Βασίλης. Η Ρώδης Αυπραξία τον άπαξε και έγινε νουνά. Αυτή ήταν η πίστη. Σήμερα ψάχνουμε να δούμε ο νονός να είναι, να έχει κάποια κοινωνική τάξη, να είναι έτσι, να είναι έτσι, σε αρέσκειάς μας. Παίρνω το παιδί, το ρίχνω στην εικόνα και τότε εμείς γελούσαμε. Είχαμε τον Ηλία που δεν είχε παντρευτεί ακόμα και λέγαμε πάρουμε τον Ηλία, το ρίξουμε μπροστά σε μια εικόνα, μήπως να πάρει καμία νύμφη. Είχαμε, διασκεδάζαμε. As George says, we have progress in some things, thank God. Look at today, you know, we have what? St. Joseph's, St. Raphael, Panagia, St. Nectarius, we have all this clergy, we have chanters. So we see this. We have lost some things. And I'm just remembering back. I don't know where it came from, but back then when there was an illness or something, people would come to the church and spend a year there, and they would fall down in the middle of the church as the royal gifts were going out, so the priests would go over them with the gifts as a blessing. And one Sunday, this young couple, they had a young daughter, Kalomira. Today she's in Greece, I think she's a grandmother now. They brought her, they put her down, I went over her with the gifts, and then afterwards I said to her, what's wrong with Kalomira? She looked, she's been diagnosed with a hole in her heart, and she's going in for surgery this week. We read some more prayers. Next Sunday, there they are, back in church with Kalomira. I said, what happened to the surgery? Father, she said, we went, the doctors did a pre-operative exam, and the hole had disappeared. I mean, so many miracles like that. Another custom that we had is that when people had a certain vow and they had a child, they wouldn't search out to see who to have as a godparent that was socially acceptable or something, you know, some criteria. They would bring the baby to the church, put the baby in front of the icon of St. Nicarius, and then a crowd of people would rush up to become the godparents. There was just instant pandemonium in the church. Vasily Kostaris, he's not here tonight, he was baptized in this way. God rest his soul, Mother Praxia became his godmother. She ran up first and grabbed him, became the godmother. Because Vasily's mom, Eleni, God rest her soul, had great faith. She brought Vasily to church, threw him in front of the icon of St. Nicarius, said, St. Nicarius, he's yours. So this faith is not there, I hate to say. We don't have that faith. We don't have that faith. But we have other things which supplement it. And I wasn't able this year because of my health to go to St. Peter and Paul camp. But I saw the videos. And when I saw those children chanting Padesava, Paraskevas, it moved me so much. Because I said to myself, this is the path. It might not be the exact duplicate of what we're doing, but it's the path. And this is what's important, is to stay on this path, the path that is steering the ship into the kingdom of heaven. This is the path that we shouldn't leave. I don't know if that answered your question, George, but this one, you got something to say?
Father has a point of view that I can't attain to because I wasn't here in the first years. And so I love hearing these stories. But we have to remind ourselves that, you know, this last, say, 100 years or so have been very difficult. We're going to celebrate the appearance of the cross in 1925. For the 100 year, we're going to celebrate the 100 year anniversary of the appearance of the cross in 1925. And so the story of, we're not old calendarists, we're traditionalists. We keep the Julian calendar. We reject the papal calendar. We keep the traditions of the fathers, and it's been difficult. You know, Father Paniotti just told his story of what he experienced, and it's funny. It's very personal for him. It's abstract for me because I read about Yakovos in New Delhi, and he forced them to all sign the Orthodox to sign the joint statement with the World Council of Churches.
And so, like,
that's the first time in New Delhi. And Father brought up that whole story about how he said, "Oh, I saw the grace of God in the Hindus." Okay, so he experienced that in a really personal way. I experienced it in just reading about it and knowing that was a very, very key time because up until New Delhi, the Orthodox always wrote a separate statement of faith. So they were there to witness to the Orthodox Church and the truth in the Church. And Father Joris Florovsky would always say, you know, you're looking for the Church, we're it. So please, you know, you're invited. And then the Protestants would get furious with him. And the other Protestants say, don't worry, he'll be here for a time and he'll be replaced. And that's what happened. And so you've got all this turmoil. So Father went through this turmoil and he found the ark. And it's funny that he said it, well, not, it's not funny, it's edifying about this story of the ship of the church versus a boat, because St. Seraphim said the same thing to the old ritualists. He says, we're in the church, we're in the ship of the church, and people have struggled to be saved, and you think you're going to be saved in that little rowboat? He said that to the old ritualists. So this is an image that the saints have used. And so we have to strive to be in the ark of the church. And so since the lifting of the anathema as well, after St. Philip reposed, there was this time of turmoil, and people argue about various aspects of the paths people took and everything, but that was a time of turmoil. And then in 2007, they finally had that union of the Soviet Church, the Moscow Patriarchate, with certain of the what was the Russian Church abroad. And they're not the Russian Church abroad anymore. They're a metropolitan district of the Moscow Patriarchate, which has been called the Soviet Church, which is anathematized by St. Joseph of Petrograd and also St. Maxim of Serpukhov, the first catacomb bishop. And these men died confessing the faith. Okay, so like the parish had this great blessing of being part of the Russian Church abroad, but then there was a time of turmoil. That's worlds colliding. For the Russian Church abroad was a very unique entity. It was over a million Russians were exiles from their country, and they had these saintly bishops and that they confessed the faith, and it brought piety to the rest of the world. And Father mentioned that whole story about, you know, Archbishop Averky, Archbishop Vitaly, but especially St. Philaret. And so, yes, there are some things that have perhaps been lost. But I thank God every day.
We have a synod.
We have a synod. Because when I converted in 1975, the monastery in Boston was under St. Philaret. And so from 75 to 85, that was the good old days. I thought, well, we have a saint for our bishop, and so I can just attend to my spiritual life. I don't have to worry anything. I converted through his writings. Like what Father was saying, when he mentioned about the sorrowful epistles, the open letter to Iacobus, the open letter to the Patriarch of Constantinople, etc., etc. These were statements made by authority, a church authority that was recognized throughout the world. Now, like the Greek old calendars, they could write things, but they didn't have the same voice that the Russians did, because there was all the controversy, and the state church was very effective in persecuting them and tamping it down and creating problems. So the Russian church had that amazing role. And so one of the things is we should thank God, though, because now we have the synod. Mm-hmm. And we have, sorry, but it's like 16 bishops. Maybe 18 bishops. But we have so many bishops that hopefully we keep an eye on each other, but there's a unity, and we can strive to confess the faith. And I thank God for our synod every single day, because this is like the good old days revisited. And may God preserve us, because the devil is going to try and create temptations and everything. But we should really know these stories. And well, we have them recorded now. And the grandparents, the parents who are now in their 40s and 50s, and the children, and then maybe the next generation, we can't forget these stories about how it was through tribulation first, but then God showed the way. And St. Nectarius greatly benefited and blessed this parish. And so we should take heart. I have some things I've been thinking about the liturgies, but now's not the time. But we need, like when Father mentioned about how it was so moving when the children chant. I mean, that's one of the most heartwarming things, is when you see small children chant. But we need to create something where we can nurse that more than we're doing now, and also encourage the next step, meaning not just, you know, boys and girls and families singing, chanting, but that's the pool. That's how it starts. But then do more at the chanting stand with God's help. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. God rest his soul. Father George, that was his forte, having the children chant. And we have a couple of generations that went through our church school learning the chants that Father George started. And now the caroling that we do, if you notice, within the caroling, we have the traditional European carols, but we also have the Byzantine carols, which was started by Father George in the church school. Back then, there were no computers or anything. We used to cut and paste to put the books together for the kids to have to chant. So children learning how to chant at home, or because we don't have the schools set up the way we used to, or at the camp, it did my heart so, you know, I couldn't go this year, it was just so bad, but I just watched the video and I said, oh my God, it's so beautiful. And it reminded me of the old days, but Father Prescott, you grew up in all that, Fatini, you guys grew up in all that, learning how to chant with Father George every Saturday, that brother, along the ecclesiastical year. And so by the time they finished 10 years in church school, they were exposed practically to every feast day. Without pressure. It was done in a funny way. Father George had his way of getting up people as a punishment. Solo, Fortini Carras, solo. That was her punishment.
I heard about that.
Yeah, the famous Father George solo.
Yeah, even I know that.
If I can just say one thing, growing up in the parish, and I know the clergy, we talk about this in our clergy meetings about, and this is a great learning for all of us, of the zeal that was in that generation, which is, we know that it is in our generation, it's just we need to make choices, because we have the worldly things and we have the church. And our generation is battling more about making those choices. So it's the zeal. And we talk about it all the time when we talk about the programs and things we want to come through and learning about the services and everything else. And that zeal fires the clergy up also. And it helps us. So the one thing that we talk about the Peter and Paul camp, and thank God that we've been doing it for 10 years. And over 100 kids every, and what is, there's nothing to stop us to doing it twice a year or three times a year. But it's the zeal, it's the zeal of the parishioners that, because it is not just 10 people, it takes an army for that to happen. So again, this is more of a reminder, if there is zeal, to approach us, to say we want to be more involved. And there is people, and I think at that time, like they said, they put a floor in one day. That's the zeal to help the church. And I think it's something that we need to continue. I know we are doing it. We need to do more of it. And I think, again, someone who was growing up in the church and seeing that, and we always talk about how much we want to do with the talks. And yes, I'll put in the plug now. In September, we're going to have a one-day talk on God is with us. And we plan to have that. And of course, God willing, we talk about more of these things, but again, it's the planning and everything that comes up. But first and foremost, it's the services. And I encourage all the altar boys and servers to learn about the services themselves. Because as someone growing up in the parish, and even Father Savas, you grew up in a parish, and Father Jeremy, we just stood there and waited for instruction. But sometimes I think back, I wish I knew what I was doing and why I was doing it. And that's the learning, I think, that I think some of our young men that need to know and understand of the why. So we need to continue that, and God willing, we will. And like Father Bonnet said, there's things that are missing, but there's a lot more we can do. And God willing, in September, we'll have a full-day talk with that and some other things. So I just wanted to mention that again about the zeal. And it takes an army to do it, so it can't be the same 10 people. God willing, it can be 50 of us.
1925.
We can do 50 of us.
Probably around the way. I don't think so.
No. Okay. So, is that it?
I think that we've had enough. The ladies have prepared all kinds of sweets and drinks for us, so please sit down and fill yourself up as much as possible.
Yeah, I should do a blessing.